Good morning. Can I welcome everybody to the fourth meeting of the Education and Culture Committee in 2015. Can I remind all those present that electronic devices should be switched off at all times, and we don't want them interfering with the electronic system. A couple of announcements before we start. Can I welcome Liz Smith back to the committee, who's here replacing Mary, because Mary's unable to be here this morning. And James Dornan, welcome to the committee, to James Dornan, who's replacing Chick Brody, who's unable to be here this morning as well. Liam MacArthur is apparently on his way, but he is missing at the moment because his plane is late. So hopefully he will join us as soon as he lands in Edinburgh. Today, item one, we continue our evidence taking on the British Sign Language Scotland Bill. Can I thank everyone who has submitted evidence to us on the BSL bill. We have received numerous BSL videos and written submissions, and our Facebook group now has over 1,900 members. So can I thank very much the clerks and others who have been working on that to support the committee's endeavours in examining the bill. Can I welcome today our first panel. We have Alan Drew, who is a member of the Scottish Deaf Youth Association, Heather Gray from the National Deaf Children's Society, Avril Hepner from British Deaf Association Scotland, Frankie McLean, who is a social care manager at Deaf Action, and Nicola Mitchell, who is a BSL tutor. So welcome to all of you this morning. Can I just say before we get started formally that we have three large panels of witnesses this morning. We have a lot of work to get through this morning. So I'm going to move straight to questions from the committee members about the bill. But can I ask witnesses, if you wish to contribute to any question or you have a point to make, please just indicate, just nod or wave, and I'll pick it up and I'll ask you to come in. Other than that, I'm just going to start the questioning now with question one, and it's going to be from Siobhan McMahon.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. The first question should be nice and easy. It's to see whether you believe that legislation is necessary to promote BSL and what specific outcomes you think this bill could bring with it.
Who wants to start? Heather.
I think the bill will bring about it the opportunity to really promote the culture of BSL in Scotland and really ensure that it has the status of a language in Scotland too. So I believe that the legislation will have a significant impact on shining the light on this very important language.
Thank you.
Yes, Frank.
I think the main thing is that we do not see ourselves as disabled. And I realise that there's a whole variety of disabilities out there, but we don't consider ourselves as disabled. And I think people are confused about what is covered under the Equalities Act and so on. Many people won't consider deaf people as disabled and therefore covered by that act. And I think it's very difficult when you're fitting linguistic issues into legislation that is designed for disability. And I think that this model of legislation is a better one that will promote the use of BSL. And I think that will be a better opportunity for us to gain access to the services that we need. At the moment, the Equalities Act is there, but it doesn't seem to be successful in respect of deaf people who use BSL. We're still going off to hospital appointments and not having access to communication support, and that's evidence that that legislation is not successful at the moment, and therefore I think that's why we need this particular bill.
Really, we just want our language, our culture, our heritage and our identity recognised in the same way that Welsh Gaelic is, in the same way that other spoken languages are. We want our language to be protected and preserved and for the risk to its demise to be reduced. So the BSL bill will protect our language into the future. It will show that we belong here, that we have a spiritual home in Scotland. That's why legislation is important to promote and preserve the language. And BSL, of course, as you become very well aware, is a language. The British Deaf Association published this dictionary many years ago, providing definitive evidence that this is a full language that needs to be recognised and accepted as a language alongside the other languages of Scotland.
Yeah, can I just add something about it being a language? It is part of our everyday lives, and it needs to be part of the way that we access services. Deaf people are hugely frustrated and depressed because of the barriers and the problems that we face in respect of linguistic access to what is going on. And, you know, deaf people just want improved quality of life, improved access to the services that we need.
Okay. I understand the points that you make about the language and how it's important to recognise that as such. However, the bill stops short of setting clear rights for BSL users or duties on public authorities. Do you think that's a limitation to the bill? And many people have said in their responses to the committee that they see the bill as a stepping stone. Do you feel that? And do you think that that's enough at the moment with this bill?
Okay, Frankie.
I think realistically we would love to have more. I think we're all agreed on that. We've had years of problems, but we would like to grab the opportunity that has been presented to us, and I think it is a first step. It is a lot better than what we have at present. I know that there are authorities who are quite sort of concerned, anxious maybe about this, and I think this would be a really good first step to get something on the statute books, a good, useful first step. Yeah.
Okay.
I think we can look at the bill as something that opens the door, if you like, for deaf people and our language, and like Frankie said, it's a very first step. This is, you know, a pioneering piece of legislation in terms of the United Kingdom, and so we welcome it with open arms, and we're ready to roll up our sleeves and do the hard work and to build on, you know, the national plan as it's stated, or statements of intent as already been mentioned, so that the authorities can have clear plans about work plans and what's going to work for us. We are prepared to wait for quality. We are, I think that's important, and the community has a very, very positive attitude to this, and we do want to move forward.
I'd like to just agree with what Avril and Frankie have just said. I think it's really important. It will be an important step to the improvement of services, and it will be gradual. You know, things will build from this. Other organisations may become involved, hopefully businesses as well will follow suit. You know, it's the 21st century, it is time for us to move forward.
Yes, Hilla.
Yep, I would agree. I think what's going to be important is that the National Plan has a very clear vision and can be linked to outcomes. That's going to be vital, that the scene is set by the National Plan and that we have the right mechanisms in place in relation to monitoring and reviewing those local plans. But importantly, that the National Plan sets out a really, really clear vision to help us achieve what we need to with this bill. But I agree, very much a stepping stone and very welcomed by all of us.
Can I, if you like, play devil's advocate, which is one of my favourite things to do, but, I mean, is the bill anything more than symbolic in its nature? I mean, effectively, it doesn't provide any more resources, it doesn't change anything particularly, it doesn't provide any more interpreters or translators. Is it nothing more than a symbol? Nicola.
I think in terms of interpreting, it will hopefully enhance the need for quality interpreters and more interpreters. Universities and colleges need to make sure that their services are accessible. I think that's right. I think it could be symbolic, but I think it's a powerful symbol, and that's why we're all here. You know, we're here, we're using BSL face to face with you. You know, you had however many kind of contributions to your Facebook page. I think that is evidence that it's a very powerful symbol.
When you say, you know, is it merely symbolic? Well, I think what it offers is perhaps a framework, a skeleton on which we can then put the flesh on and develop as time goes on. The national plan will hopefully cascade down to those local authorities, but you've got to have a framework, you've got to have a structure within to put these ideals, aspirations, and eventually service expectations. So the fact that it's about our language and the recognition of our language, and that is the focus of it, rather than our disability, our linguistic rights, I would say that's a pretty good symbolic start.
Can I just ask one further follow-up question before I bring in the next member of the committee? You mentioned, Frankie mentioned at the start about the Equality Act from 2010. You seem to be suggesting that that was not sufficient to meet the kind of objectives that you're hoping that the BSL bill will meet. Could you maybe expand on that a little bit, why the Equalities Act is insufficient to meet the objectives that you hope that the BSL bill will?
Well, I have a social work background and a personal experience as well, and I see horror stories every day occurring with deaf people, people who are going in to hospital, who are sort of waiting for hours or months even without really knowing what's going on in terms of their treatment, people who have problems accessing college courses and who withdraw from college education because there is no provision for them. People who think the experiences that you take for granted on an everyday basis are problematic for deaf people. Some deaf people, for example, have got into debt because of lack of understanding of some of the information that's been sent to them in written English. They see letters in English. They ignore them because they don't understand them. They then get into debt. Their situations become more and more problematic. You know, they end up in crisis before any help is asked for. Because of data protection, it is very hard for them to interact with financial services and institutions through a third party, like through an interpreter or through another representative who wants to act on their behalf. And the Equalities Act is not dealing with this. People and organisations find ways of working around the Equalities Act. Also, the Equalities Act talks about reasonable adjustment, and it's very hard to define what that actually means. And a lot of organisations will say that those adjustments that might be reasonable for deaf people are too expensive, particularly when it comes to language issues. And so the adjustments that deaf people need are deemed not reasonable, and this is really a loophole in that legislation. You know, if I want to go to a solicitor, who has to pay for the interpreter? You know, I do. Legal aid won't cover. They cover the first appointment, the costs of, but not the interpreting costs. If I want to buy a house, you know, I need to interact with a lawyer. Legal aid doesn't cover that. So, you know, what do I do when I want to buy a house, for example? So those are just some very quick examples. I could go on for hours and give you some real horror stories of experiences that deaf people have had.
Before I bring in Nicola and Avril, I just want to pursue this for one second. I know we'll get into some of the detail of this in a moment, but you just gave a number of examples, Frankie, about people getting into debt or trying to buy a house, for example, and how the Equalities Act obviously doesn't in any way help with any of these day-to-day situations. But how do you believe that the BSL bill will help with those everyday situations? In what way will the BSL bill prevent somebody from getting into debt, for example?
Awareness of the language needs of deaf people and to make sure that information is accessible in that language. And the recognition that BSL is a language, because people really don't understand what BSL is all about. You know, they maybe don't think of it and consider it as a proper language. It's just people sort of, you know, waving their hands around. So they don't consider linguistic issues when they think about BSL. And I think about having this legislation would identify it as a language, would recognise that the issues for BSL users are to do with language and linguistic access, and also to celebrate, you know, the richness of that language. You know, at the moment, people, organisations can ignore that, and I think, you know, we want to access life through using our own language, and I think legislation that encourages a change of attitude towards the language and identifies it as a language is necessary.
Nicola and then Avril.
I'd just like to agree with what Frankie says through my own personal experience. You know, in going to the bank and sitting down with a financial advisor and dealing with transactions to do with my house, I had similar problems just accessing, you know, the fundamental information. You know, people saying, well, you need to come back in 2 weeks, that's when we can do something. It's like, well, I need access to that information right now. So I often felt that there were a lot of barriers and it was very difficult for me in those areas of my life. Similarly, you know, in going visiting the tax office website, trying to deal with written language, informing people of my own language needs, that lack of awareness, the lack of fundamental awareness, you know, means that you just often you give up, and deaf people end up having to go and do things face to face, losing, you know, taking more time, you know, and not having real equality of access. So I think, like Frankie says, that attitudinal and cultural shift that's brought about by a promotional bill may well help. Really, when you talk about the Equality Act, you say it does work for some people, but it clearly isn't working for the sign language using deaf community. Frankie mentioned reasonable adjustment earlier on. That whereby services can provide, you just write things down on a bit of paper rather than providing an interpreter, which resorts back to English, which doesn't give us the full access via our preferred language. A bill like this can state that provision of services in BSL is something that deaf people should have. We've talked about reasonable adjustment not working. The British Deaf Association in 2014 did carry out a wide-ranging survey, which I have here, into the legal status of British Sign Language and ISL, Irish Sign Language. And the clear results, and the proof is here, I'm happy to supply this to the committee if you want, is that the Equalities Act is not working for sign language using deaf people. If you also look at page 7 of this report, in the last paragraph, we talk about the very important area of education for deaf children. When you ask MSPs and MPs, you know, whether deaf children will receive their education in sign language, the overwhelming response is, well, of course, that's the case. But the Grimes report in 2009 says something quite contrary. 8% of teachers of the deaf can sign. 8%? Well, that means 92% can't. So how are these children accessing their education? How are they setting up the foundations for their well-being and their future? We need an act that states that children should be educated in the language and the culture that they belong to, giving them full access to information. So we need a separate act, an act that has British Sign Language in its title. That may well lead to future access and future provision for the deaf community.
Thank you. I want to bring in some of the committee now, because I know there's a number of questions that members have. Can I start with Colin?
Thank you, Mayor. Some organisations have expressed concern that the bill uses up scarce resources. And if I can quote from COSLA, they state there's a risk it will become simply an expensive bureaucratic exercise. Can I ask the panel, if they had a choice, would they be spending the resources on developing plans, or would they rather have the resources spent in another way, more effectively supporting BSL users? It's just a very open question.
Thank you.
When we're talking about spending, we need to think about, at the moment, the government is spending an awful lot on deaf people. Most deaf people don't work. They try to find work, but they don't. So they're on benefits. So they're not actively contributing to our economy. They're excluded from that. So an investment now, as a result of this bill, will save money in the long term in terms of services to deaf people. If people are able to interact and contribute to the economy more, then there will be other costs that will be saved later on. For example, mental health and in education. If we don't do anything now, there will be increased costs later on as a result. But if we invest in trying to ensure that deaf people are active members of society, are able to share their experiences, their knowledge with other members of society, then we will all benefit.
Heather.
Is timely. It comes alongside the National Sensory Impairment Strategy as well. It comes at a time when we've got a focus on the attainment gap for deaf learners. I think, as Frankie says, it's a stepping stone. It really allows us to have a focus on children and young people and on a whole range of issues for deaf people in Scotland that will help support better outcomes for people and an investment in the future. So I think the timing of the bill is very good in relation to other areas of focus, but I think in particular this focus that we now have on the attainment gap that exists for deaf children and on some of the issues that have been raised in the recent CRIDE survey, which have been picked up upon earlier around about qualifications for teachers of the deaf, consistency of support for deaf learners in Scotland too. So I think that issue around about timing and the plans being absolutely right in terms of the kind of issues that they're capturing and a real focus on improving the outcomes for deaf children and ultimately for deaf adults.
Apple.
When you talk about the cost and the expenditure, as you have, as has been said, this could be a strategic investment for the long term to save public money. If we give deaf people the quality start in life, then they will, like Frankie said, contribute. There's a lot of misdirected and unstrategic spending on the deaf community that's going on at the moment. Now, what we would like to see is a cross-department, cross-party, joint working together so that we actually target and strategize, because we see an awful lot of duplication and repetition of services. For example, across the NHS and the other public services, with the advancement of technology and the increasing of online services, this isn't done in a centralised way that could easily work in Scotland, where we join the dots between these services so that we have a full, comprehensive, cohesive picture, giving us value for money for each pound we spend. I agree wholeheartedly with Frankie that an investment now will make all of us, not the deaf community, but the whole of Scotland, better off in the future.
The point that Avril made in relation to the current spending for BSL. Avril seemed to be indicating that it wasn't being spent perhaps as wisely as it should be. Perhaps you could add a little bit to that.
Okay, for example, um,
With the NHS services across Scotland, they very much have their own individual localised plans of how they're going to meet deaf people's needs. And if they actually joined up, for example, with interpreting services on the access via technology, if it was done in a centralised way, rather than all these pots of money being drained locally, if we planned these things properly in the first place, I'm sure you would agree with me that we'd have an economy of scale. It would just make sense. Does that answer your question?
Understand where Apple's coming from.
Yeah, can I just add to that? That the number of ESL users in different areas varies widely. In some areas there'll be a large number of deaf people, in others they will be very few and far between. Having a centralised system will be far more cost effective, I'm sure.
And can I just add, it's occurred to me that another example that might illustrate is when you look at deaf children in schools across Scotland, there is an awful lot of expenditure on itinerant and visiting teachers of the deaf that can't sign very well, as I've already said, the communication support workers that aren't trained very well and giving ineffectual support. So if we actually strategically employed deaf people to support our deaf students, it would be a lot cheaper than and cost-effective, and give much better outcomes. Which is far more important. As I explained earlier, a lot of the so-called professionals working in this area don't have the sign language skills necessary to meet the needs of these the deaf students. So, what we would like to see, is really as able to exploit the potential of the deaf community and our skills and experiences to bring up our children in the way that they deserve.
Yeah, I totally agree with that.
Can I just ask Alan whether, given his he's representing here younger people today, if he has a view on this?
Young deaf people often live very isolated lives in terms of their family, their social life, their education. They find it difficult to get good employment outcomes. They're underemployed. They can't get promotion. And I can't emphasise many areas of improvement. As I've said, for example, job interviews can be incredibly difficult for deaf people to navigate very well. But often, employers and educational establishments have an attitude that is extremely unhelpful to deaf people's needs. And then a bill like this that states the language rights of deaf people will go a long way to improving that.
Okay, thank you.
From the panel, what they understand by the term promotion of BSL, what specific things should that entail? What should be included in that promotion?
Yes, Alan.
Well, when you look at promotion of BSL, what it means to me is, first of all, it's been said earlier, it proves that it's a language. So education establishments and employers, hopefully will have an attitudinal shift. I think that's, and a cultural shift, I think that's the first key step. And a promotion, I think, can also mean much more of an acceptance of the access needs of deaf people throughout our society.
In my experience, it's not only deaf people who might benefit, but hearing people too. Hearing people are usually fascinated when they're exposed to BSL and very keen to learn more. But they have a limited choice in where they can go and learn that, and often they're disappointed because things aren't accessible in their locality. And I think the potential for having BSL on the curriculum, for example, would improve the awareness of hearing people. It would improve their language skills. They could become bilingual as well in English and BSL. That would mean that there would be far more interaction between sort of deaf and hearing people. It would be really useful. It could be fun for hearing people, would involve a lot more interaction and involvement within the wider society for deaf people. And I think promotion of BSL would certainly involve promoting the learning of it with hearing people.
I think it's like I've already said, the dictionary a couple of decades ago recognised our language as having its own grammar, syntax and structure, putting it on an absolute equal footing with any other language. I think we all agreed that this is a recognised language. It's not just gestures or mimes. And for me, promotion means, I think, well, Frankie's already mentioned, you know, the national our national curriculum. It would be terrific to recognise the benefits that sign language can confer. I mean, for somebody to grow up bilingual, their career opportunities, you know, not only in that language, of course, they could work as a social worker or an interpreter within the language group. We'd have the cost effectiveness of that, but bilingualism is good anyway. In terms of deaf people having partners, family members, I don't know if you know that 95% plus deaf children are born to hearing families. So if we promote this language within the wider community, when people have deaf children, they're going to be able to communicate at least fundamentally with them. So the quality of life that it would promote, that's what I think of when I think of promotion. And we keep going back to this, but changing attitudes, gaining acceptance, respecting our language, on a par with other spoken languages, that's a really important principle, and it means that deaf Scottish people will feel that they truly belong in their own country.
Okay, thank you. Could you be very brief, because we've got a lot to get through, Heather?
Dingwall Academy and the 1+2 initiative there, where students are learning BSL as a second language, and perhaps that being one of an opportunity, certainly a great example of good practice.
Thank you very much. Colin, are you finished? Thank you. James.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. A number of comments suggested there could be some unintended consequences of the bill, and primarily it could have a detrimental effect on the available resources to support people with other communication needs. Would you agree with that? Could other communication needs for deaf people be negatively affected by the BSL bill, and if so, in what ways?
Frankie.
I think at the moment, BSL should be an option for anyone who chooses to use it. But it's really not an option because of lack of resources, lack of support and so on. So BSL is often an option for families with deaf children that they don't take up. And as Avril said, the vast majority of deaf children are born into hearing families. Hearing families who don't know how to communicate with their child, who don't know where to go and learn BSL and maybe not advised to do that. Deafness obviously covers a whole broad range of individuals who will communicate in different ways. Not all will use sign language. Some will lip read and speak, for example, and that's fine. I'm thinking about how many of those would actually welcome the opportunity to learn BSL if it was available to them. And I'm confident that a lot more people would actually access BSL tuition if they were able to do so, because hearing loss can have a profound effect on the lives of individuals, can really impact on their ability to communicate and so on, can cause a great deal of frustration and often depression. Often single parents, for example, who lose their hearing will have hugely problematic issues communicating with their children. It can involve a lot of stress. People can really struggle in their individual circumstances. And I think having BSL as an option that is accessible for more people to learn would actually benefit a lot of hard of hearing people as well. It would give them another choice that could help them access services.
Sorry,
and
can
life.
I
think it could be very positive for other people.
Can I interrupt for a second, though? I mean, I think Mr. Donnan's question wasn't so much about the response that Mr. McLean just gave and the benefits. I think many of us recognise the benefits if it was widely available. The question is directly about the impact on resources. If the resource allocation for deaf community within a council or other communication needs is limited, if it's a fixed pot of money, I think the question, I'm paraphrasing here, but the question is effectively about what would the impact be on that pot of money if some of it had to be used because of legislation, for example, for the plans and the promotion, etc. If that was because I'm not confident at the moment that there would be extra money provided to do this, that the money would remain the same, but some of the money would then have to be allocated for promotion, etc. What would the impact be on BSL users then? I think that's, I'm paraphrasing the question.
I was actually going to come back in and make exactly the point you made, convener.
Sorry. So I don't know whether Frankie would maybe respond directly to that point.
Well, I think, I was emphasising the positives, and I know that there are concerns about this. The honest answer is we don't know. But I think when I consider the spending that is happening at the moment in relation to deaf people, I think that there would be a lot of savings. For example, there isn't much spending on lip reading classes at the moment. The spending is the other way around. There is more spending on BSL users than there are on the other groups of deaf people.
The opposite.
Sorry. Interpreter's mistake.
Frankie's last point was that he believes that the current suite of services that are available, if you look at it right now, there's much more spending on the other forms of communication than BSL.
Okay.
That's the status quo at the moment.
Right, okay.
No, just to clarify. At the moment, other communication methods, we're not totally sure what the spending is on them, but I actually don't think that there is that much spending on them anyway.
I'd like to say that, you know, a BSL bill would make the BSL needs more visible, because I feel that they're not visible enough within that spectrum of needs and services to meet those needs. Okay. I don't think there would be any negative effects at all, to be honest. I think what we have to bear in mind is that BSL is a language. All the other communication needs you're talking about, sign-supported English, that's not a language. It's an artificial communication system. Makiton that's available, I don't know if you're aware of that, that's for people who have got special needs on top of, additional disabilities perhaps. So there shouldn't really be any negative unintended effects. I mean, if we consider the amount of funding that's been given to cochlear implantation over the last few decades, well, if we can spend money in that direction, we can certainly, via a bill, point people and direct them to spending in this way. There should not be any negative effects at all. We're talking about, a language issue here, as distinct from, I mean, the other services are for people who don't use that language. So I think that there are two separate issues, and this is it would be good for us to focus on the language side of things. We talked about the See Here strategy and what's going ahead. I mean, we're obviously very supportive of, having a very wide and open attitude to the spectrum of deafness and the services, but I have a very strong belief that a BSL bill would have no negative unintended consequences.
Okay, thank you. Heather.
Can I just
say that we are, as an organisation, seeing quite significant cuts in sensory services right across Scotland, and I think we do actually need to be aware that there is some potential for financial resources to be diverted away from additional support required, for example, for deaf children in the classroom, particularly around about communication support workers, radio aids, improved acoustics. So I do think seeing the situation right across Scotland just now and seeing the constraints and budgets, that we do actually need to be cautious around about that.
Come back to you then on that, Heather. Yes. Have you got any suggestions about how we can mitigate those circumstances?
Some funding attached to the bill.
One response.
Yeah, I mean, I do believe that, that the bill will require funding and resourcing, given the fact that we know there to be inconsistencies across Scotland and we know there to be gaps in services just now. I think services are working incredibly hard just now to build capacity and to use resources as effectively as possible, but we are seeing significant cuts to budgets and real pressures on councils just now. So my concern would be, unless there's financial resources attached to the bill, it may well be difficult to fulfil the obligation.
I have one more question. Yes. Do you think the bill should include specific reference to the needs of deaf-blind BSL users, and if so, in what way?
It should, because deaf-blind people are deaf primarily, and then they will lose their vision later in life. They are people who rely on BSL. Yes, I think at the moment deaf-blind communication might involve a hands-on, tactile form of BSL. That is BSL anyway. So basically what we're talking about is BSL. It's just a different form of BSL. I'm not a sort of a linguistic academic, and so maybe other people can tell me if I'm wrong there.
I think, like Frankie said, you know, deaf-blind people have are a distinct group within our community and have their own extra needs. I think what's important is to just make sure that they are included in the. If we're talking about including the deaf community within the wider society, then we also need to consider how the deaf-blind minority within the deaf community is part of that picture.
Thank you, Liz Smith.
Obviously, as the bill stands just now, there is a proposal that there should be one minister who has a specific responsibility for BSL. And the Scottish Government has come back and said that actually all ministers should have responsibility because of the collective role that their portfolios have. Could I just ask you whether you do feel that there should be a specific minister with responsibility, and if so, what additional benefit that could bring?
I think what we would like to see is a minister being given primary responsibility to oversee that whole picture, to take the lead on British Sign Language flowing from an act of Parliament. But I mean, we'd like to have our cake and eat it, I suppose. You know, we'd like cross department and cross party support for this, so that there is a synergy between the head and the heart and the actual services that are then provided. So we'd like that strong overview and leadership, so that somebody is accountable for it, but that they would then delegate those responsibilities across all departments. This would benefit all parts of that equation, because there would be a clear roadmap, a clear strategy of who's responsible for what. But that oversight, we feel, is a very important aspect. It would also be cost effective. I mean, don't forget that we're talking, hopefully, about having a national advisory group that would work in very strong cooperation with all government departments to ensure that we take the right path in ensuring a better future.
I'm sure yourselves you've been looking in depth at all the paperwork in relation to this bill. And you probably have a much more in-depth knowledge about it than other ministers here. And I think it would be really invaluable to have somebody who has accrues an in-depth knowledge about BSL and about the processes and the needs involved.
Can I just follow up on this point? Because if there is an advisory body, a national advisory body, and there is also a minister with responsibility, could you be clear about what each of the roles would be? How would the minister's role differ from that of the national advisory group?
I'll briefly respond to that. I think there are a lot of issues that need to be discussed, and that the advisory group would be the place for those discussions to take place, to benefit from individuals' experiences and so on. But the minister is the person who needs to kind of take that overview, summarise the thoughts of the advisory group, present them to Parliament. The advisory group is where the discussions can happen and feed into the process, and that will be done through the minister.
Just be clear about that answer. If it is the responsibility of the minister to set the priorities, would it be your expectation that these priorities come from the national advisory body?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
What I would like to stress, I mean, we've talked about the minister obviously taking the lead in terms of Parliament and legislation, and the advisory group. What we would like to see is that group really represented, say, in a majority, 75% or more of experts within the field who have a connection with the community, with what's going on, so that we provide the link between the plans, the bridge, if you like, between what the plans and feed in to what's the strategy from the actual needs of the community. So if you ensure that there is that 75% of vast majority of Scottish deaf BSL users in that group, I mean, and you obviously organisations like COSLA and the others need to be part of those lengthy discussions. But, you know, if you look at formulating a national plan and supporting authorities to do that plan, you know, members of that group could provide that very vital link between the national parliament and all those services that are being rolled out across the country. I hope that's clear, is it?
Can I just finish on the point? There must be an expectation on other portfolios in government that this has an impact, whether it runs across education, it runs across health, it runs across social responsibility. I'm just slightly nervous about one minister having that responsibility. I think that's the point the Scottish Government's making. Would you see any way forward of trying to ensure that there is a collective responsibility on this?
I'm not sure I'm really going to answer that, but if we look at the Gaelic model and just consider whether or how effective that is in relation to this, and then maybe either, if it's effective, follow the same model, and if it's not, do something different.
Just linked to what Frankie just said, if we spread the responsibility around, then it's spread perhaps too thin. We would like to see some sort of accountability, a shared responsibility, if you like. There's one minister that takes the lead, because it is a promotional bill, and they take the lead over the other departments, but the advisory group provides that vital link to local authorities and services. And like Frankie says, I mean, we can look at the spoken language models and see if they will apply and if they'll work to the British Sign Language situation.
Okay, can I ask about a particular issue that was raised in effect by the Scottish Government? The Scottish Government suggested the requirement to for listed authorities to publish a plan should be replaced with the requirement to publish a BSL statement. I just wondered whether the panel felt that a statement would be a better way of driving improvement and measuring progress than a plan. Heather.
I actually think that it's important that it is plans and that those plans have momentum and that there's accountability for those plans and that we can see progress towards the bill. I think there's a bit of a fear if it's a statement that it could be a tick box exercise. I think it's important that it is plans and that there are accountabilities around about that and that there is measurable outcomes in terms of the progress to achieving the aspirations of this bill.
The government's view in terms of the bill at the moment, certainly, as it's laid out, was that there should be a national plan and that each authority plan, if you like, would be a statement, and the statement would be how they would achieve the outcomes as laid out in the national plan, how they would drive forward their responsibilities towards the outcomes in a national plan. Is there a problem with that model, or are there any issues with that model?
And is the accountability and keeping the momentum going behind those local plans and, you know, how accountable the local plans are and people are to delivering against those. I think what's going to be critical is that the national plan and the national advisory group are very explicit in the responsibilities for reporting back. I think there's a danger that it becomes an exercise where we don't see progress. It needs to have some momentum behind it. It needs to have some accountability in terms of deliverables.
I'm trying to understand. Let me probe this just a little bit more and understand why you feel you're obviously expressing concern about a statement,
yeah,
as opposed to a plan. I'm trying to understand why you think that a statement would be worse than a plan. A statement would be a tick box exercise, but a plan wouldn't be a tick box exercise, because it could equally be a tick box exercise if you want to make it like that. And surely if a local body has to publish a statement detailing how it will achieve the outcomes in the national plan, as long as the national plan has that detail in it, surely a statement from that local authority, for example, saying this is how we intend to do this, how we intend to achieve, or how we intend to make progress towards the outcomes in the national plan, that's not a tick box exercise, but in fact it's actually quite a focused way of achieving the outcomes as laid out in the national plan.
Yes, I mean, I think providing it's about report, there is a reporting mechanism back, and there is a sense that within that statement there's intent and action that can be measurable, and that people can see a tangible improvement. I think that's the critical part. I think there's been a number of examples where there has been statements, but no intent and no movement behind them. So I think the important factor being that there's actually the intent in terms of how the local plans would be delivered is really important, and the role of the National Advisory Council or committee or whatever it is that's created in having some kind of accountability and monitoring of that.
So can I just so we're absolutely clear on this point, that what, and I'll come to other members of the panel in one moment, that the important point is the principle, if you like, here is that you have the intent and the monitoring and the progress and the publication of outcomes. It's all of that kind of detail that you're concerned about, and whether it's a statement or whether it's a plan is in a sense slightly less important. It's the fact that it has to have, yes, there's some solidity behind it,
yes,
effectively,
yes,
and accountability.
Absolutely. And I think having the national task group is critical to that, and having the momentum behind that as well, so that there's accountability.
Okay, thank you. I believe Frankie and I think Avril as well wanted to contribute here. Frankie and then Avril, yeah.
Key to success of this bill is that public bodies should really think about, consider what the issues are for them, for the services that they offer. And these will be individual to the different listed authorities. They really need to carefully consider what is involved for them. They will have the national plan, and they can think about how they can achieve those issues off the national plan, but that won't, in a statement, indicate that they're kind of really exploring the issues as they experience them in their particular field. And I think it's really important that each authority really considers very carefully about their particular circumstance and what is required in that situation. So it's got to be contextually relevant. It's not about ticking the boxes off the national plan. That can work to a certain extent, but I think it will be far more effective if they have individual authority plans.
I think the local authorities' plans should be really focused around action points, you know, whereas, I mean, the national plan will obviously make what we hope are statements of intent, which have some sort of force behind them, because so that the public authorities understand that they need to do these needs analysis and follow what's outlined in the statement of intent. The British Deaf Association has our BSL charter, which already mentions a great deal of those things. Pages 24 to 26 cover a pretty similar content and context about a statement of intent that encourages police authorities, councils, health authorities to sign up and support, make a pledge, if you like. There are five central pledges within the Charter, as an example, to work together in this strategic way to make sure that the needs of the community are covered. So. When we talk about a statement, we really want to see a statement of intent. And the last word, intent, is the most important one, I feel, because it actually strengthens the statement and takes something that exists in philosophy and puts it into practice.
Okay, thank you very much. Gordon.
Thanks very much, Convener. We've just heard how important it is to have plans in place. However, we heard from some of the written evidence that information on what should be included in a BSL plan is currently quite vague. And we've also heard from COSLA that there was a lack of clarity. So what are the panel's view on what should be included in both national and authority plans in order that they can be effective?
Yes, Avril.
I think there's five key areas that I could summarise these into. I think the Facebook comments have highlighted this as well as the other evidence. The area of education is key. Following that, health. Social care, particularly for elderly deaf people suffering from dementia and other conditions, that's an identified gap in services. To promote leisure, cultural, artistic inclusion of deaf people is a fourth. And the fifth area that is equally important is employment. So to go back to education, we've mentioned this issue before, deaf children's access to their own education in their own language so that they acquire a holistic well-being that gives them a sound foundation for their future. We've talked about interpreters health services, but we have growing mental health issues and we don't have counsellors that are competent. The employment opportunities for deaf people, as I'm sure you appreciate, are woefully inadequate and behind the general population. So I think those are the five key areas that I would like to highlight.
I totally agree with what Avril's just said. I'd just like to add in there early years and early intervention. So support for families who have deaf babies, making sure that they get the right support in those early years to facilitate kind of growth, development and healthy lives thereafter.
Sorry, Heather, yes.
About the early years,
you know, and family sign, for example. We don't in Scotland have a national programme for family sign, which is really vital in terms of really supporting that those 90% of parents who are hearing, who have a deaf child, and really promote a means of communication in the early years. We know how significant and important the early years are. So just to really reinforce that point about early years being critical in the plans in terms of action.
Thank you very much.
Just one quick one. You've mentioned five or six key areas that you feel should be included in national and authority plans, but should there be more detail on the content of plans included in the bill?
See a lot more detail, a lot more flesh on the bones. But as you've already said, you know, maybe not in the face of the bill. I mean, this is more belonging in the national plan, providing that link between the legislation and the practice, like we've said. I mean, adding in early intervention, as Frankie said, would give us six key areas. And as long as there was a clear link between those areas and a prioritisation, I mean, obviously, we have to think of this as a long-term iterative process. You know, the world changes, new issues will come up, and we need to be flexible and adaptable.
Okay, thank you. George.
Thank you, Convener. I would like to ask about the performance review that's proposed. The bill proposes that each parliamentary session, Scottish ministers should undertake a performance review, and that provides an account of measures taken and outcomes attained. Now, I've read the British Deaf Association Scotland's evidence, and it says if there is a performance review, chosen evaluation approach, it should not be a simple tick box exercise. It should be both formative and summative evaluation component. But when you talk to COSLA then have come back and saying local authorities having to report to the Scottish Government on this, it could be quite difficult, and they actually don't like that. They think it should possibly go down the idea of community planning partnerships. Now, what do we think? How could we, if we went down the COSLA route of the community planning partnerships, how could we get a national picture of where things lie with the reviews and the outcomes in BSL?
Have one.
Okay. That's a good question. If you have a wide performance review that focuses on two areas, I mean, you've talked about the difference between formative, you know, regular iterative reviews that can provide quick fixes and solutions to issues identified, and a summative assessment that takes a longer view on achievements and improvements. But I think you're quite right. It's important that the review comes from the community itself. And you need that local, you need to tap into that local knowledge about what's happening on the ground. So the performance review, the answer is both. The local performance reviews should feed into a national picture. To give you perhaps an example, you know, the BDA, we have a project, a participation project that we're working on now, where we consult and review our services to the community. And that could provide a model for how this may work between authorities and councils and the larger context. The COSLA response has said that they want, you know, this done on a local basis, and of course we would put an and in there, not an or. This is very important that we get those local contributions so we understand what's happening, but that it feeds in and gives us a national picture.
So if I'm saying this correctly, Avril, then possibly you're saying that we do have to stick with the idea of a national plan, the national review, but obviously feed in at the community planning level as well.
Yes, that's correct. I think that you would look at both of them. I mean, the local stuff would be very much the everyday access. What's going on the ground, you know, and for that to be regular and would make it effective. So, and that's the community partnership model that you talk about, where we've got this collaborative data collection, if you like, that provides for those reviews.
Okay, one of the only things that's mentioned is that if an authority isn't performing in the correctly for with the national picture, the idea they're talking about is of naming and shaming authorities. Now, do you think this is enough, or do you think there would have to be more to deal with the whole situation? If there was, if the national picture came back and said there was areas that weren't actually delivering?
Thank you.
I think that's a tough question, actually, because, yes, I think sanctions might make people more proactive, but it might also lead to them setting very insubstantial targets in the first place. Because if they're worried about sanctions, then they'll just kind of make things easier to achieve. So I think that it's a kind of balancing act, maybe. I think that's something that will need to be incorporated into the reviewing process. I think it would be good for authorities to be allowed to aim high and fail, but be supported in that. If they continually fail, then that's when sanctions might need to be brought in. But I think, it's a bit of a carrot and stick act at the moment, I think, I think you need to sort of, tread sort of quite gently to begin with, maybe.
So possibly saying naming and shaming is, that's probably, that's the only sanction there is. So that's probably, eventually, if things continually go down a route of non-compliance.
Yes, I think so.
I think that maybe...
if you could somehow look at, as Frankie said, how often failure happens and what support has been given, though, when inadequacies have been identified. And so the focus is on resolving, looking at a positive way forward when issues are identified. And only, I think, when a clear, authorities are clearly ignoring or disregarding those, could there be some sort of sanction. But in terms of the bill itself being a promotional bill and whether it's got the strength to do that, I'm not entirely sure. But I think the key is that we've got to be supportive in the first, second, third, so many instances, because ultimately, like you say, sanctions will be limited, so it would have to be seen as a last resort.
Alan.
I mean, we could also look at the best practice model, a best performance model. So authorities or organisations that are not doing so well can look to those that are succeeding. That's very much a constructive, collaborative way of celebrating success and using that as blueprints for how other authorities and organisations can improve.
We're really struggling for time, Frankie, so you need to be very quick.
I think examples of good practice exist currently, but what we'd like is some consistency across the nation. And I don't think it would be difficult to model and share those examples of good practice.
Avril, if you just talk, I've got a question which follows on from what Frankie's just said, just to finish off today. And it's really, so you can maybe come in on this. The Scottish Government has actually suggested that the BSL National Advisory Group could undertake collective consultation on authority plans. Now, this is, I think, to avoid local groups or small groups being swamped by requests to undertake reviews of local plans. I just wondered what your view was of a collective consultation process driven from the centre, if you like, rather than more localised consultation by lots of different groups, with the danger, of course, of certain groups being swamped with requests for reviews, etc. Alan.
Well, local consultation is good, but I mean, what you have got to consider, there's how many authorities, and there is the potential of people being over-surveyed and things being missed. But this collective consultation, certainly has some advantages, perhaps picking up the gaps, but I think rather than either or, it's an and situation. But yeah, the collective consultation seems in theory like a good idea.
Avril.
Um,
I mean, what first of all we'd like to say is, you know, like the Facebook initiative that the Scottish Parliament took is an excellent example of being open and outward facing, being consultative in a very cost effective way. You'd have to say, I mean, you know how many contributions you've had. So we'd like to congratulate you on that and say this should be an ongoing part of a consultation process with the deaf community. Local consultations can, of course, happen, but rather than making them too onerous, what we can do is, what you can do is tap into the expertise of organisations such as the British Deaf Association. We've already got our participation survey going on. We're doing this outreach work in the community. There's evidence and work available that can feed into the process. There isn't a need to reinvent the wheel constantly. And there are really good, cost-effective ways for the government to leverage the expertise from our organisations and from technology such as Facebook so that we do allow that vital local knowledge to be fed up into these plans. And, you know, it doesn't need to be expensive, it doesn't need to be time consuming or onerous. If we're strategic about it, I think we can have our cake and eat it.
One final question, which I want to just, it should be a very quick yes or no answer really, but the timescale suggested by the bill, and I think this is complicated, so I want to read it out properly. The bill proposes that the national plan should be produced no later than 6 months after the start of each parliamentary session, and that authority plans should be published no later than 6 months after the national plan, but for the first set of plans, the relevant period should be 12 months. That, to me, is a complicated way to do it, and I think the government agrees. They've suggested a 5 or a 7 year cycle for plans, which is more in line with the Gaelic Language Act. And I just wondered what your view on that was. Heather?
Just sounds very complicated. I think if we've got something that works for Gaelic, then we should be adopting that for BSL.
Okay, thank you. And the rest of the panel agree with that?
Yeah. If it works, use it.
Okay. Avril, did you?
It's not a yes or no answer, I'm afraid. But I'll be brief. I mean, we'd like to see, you know, very much, you know, as much achieved in the first session as possible, I suppose. But I mean, because, I mean, you know, 5 or 7 year plans, you know, our concern, of course, is that when you think of the education of deaf children, this is 5 or 7 years in their lives. So all their opportunities are lost over a long time period like that. So it very much depends on which part of the strategy and the service provision we're looking at.
That's very helpful. Can I? We've gone a little bit over time, I should say, but that's been very informative and very welcome. Can I thank you all for your contributions this morning? I'm sure the committee got a lot out of this first panel session, so thank you very, very much. I'm going to suspend now for 5 minutes to allow us to change over witnesses. Thank you. Can I welcome now our second panel this morning? We have Katy Hetherington from NHS Health Scotland, Nigel Firth from NHS Grampian, Lorraine Vallance, who's a member of the Scottish Universities Disability Services Group, Robert Nicol from COSLA, and Maria Dick, who's from Forth Valley Sensory Centre and is also representing COSLA as well. I'm just going to run straight into the questions from committee members to the second panel this morning, and again I'll begin with Siobhan McMahon.
Thank you, Convener. We heard in the first panel this morning that the users felt that BSL was necessary to be put in legislation. Do you agree with that?
I think that primary legislation is one option. From discussing with the NHS Grampian disability groups, they came up with a range of options, which I'm happy to put forward. Primary legislation, yes, is one option. A voluntary code of conduct or guidance would be a second option. And perhaps a third option would be reinterpreting or adding to existing legislation. As I'm sure you know, the General Duty Section F of the Disability Discrimination Act 2005 has a number of elements within it, such as a legal duty to promote equality of opportunity for disabled people, and very significantly, Section F takes steps to meet disabled people's needs, even if this requires more favourable treatment. And again, the Equality Act 2010 also contains elements within it which could be used. The consensus view of our disability groups in Grampian, and indeed on Orkney as well, was that perhaps reinterpreting existing legislation using the Equality and Human Rights Commission for Scotland as the primary enforcement body might be a sensible first step. And if that was not sufficient, perhaps then primary legislation should be considered.
Okay. Does anyone else have any views before?
I think I'd probably agree with that. There's a variety of ways for promoting anything, and I think clearly primary legislation is one, but there are other mechanisms out there. I'm going to add another one to that, and that's through government policy as well, which can be developed in a collaborative way. We already have the See Here strategy, and I'm sure we'll discuss that a little bit more. But another policy that was discussed in the first panel was 1+2 languages. So clearly there are a variety of ways that policy and practice and government policy can be shaped to promote a particular subject. So it's not necessarily that primary legislation is the only route to deliver what was clearly felt was from the first panel was something strongly felt.
Okay, I mean, in your answer, sorry.
Really just to echo that, from Health Scotland's perspective, we very much support the thinking behind the bill in terms of promoting BSL. And from our perspective, in order to tackle health inequalities and promote equity of access to health services, it's very much something that we want to see all our public bodies doing. But we do believe that there are levers within the current equality legislation, and in particular the human rights framework, which we maybe want to talk a little bit more about in terms of the right to health and a human rights-based approach that public authorities could take. And we think probably potentially by looking at how we can use those levers better, we might achieve the outcomes that the BSL bill is intending to achieve.
In the answers that you've given, all the panel members tended to focus on disability and not necessarily the language opportunities. And we heard from panel one, I think it was Frankie McLean, who said that deaf people don't see themselves as disabled, and yet every answer that we've been getting back is about the Disability Discrimination Act, how you see a disabled person, how they can focus. So if that is the way that you wish to see the bill, do you think that that's a problem in the outset?
I recognise completely where the BSL community are coming from in terms of being recognised as a language issue and not as a disability issue. And that's where I think potentially the human rights framework might provide that leverage in achieving that. Non-discrimination is part of the human rights-based approach, and in terms of realising people's rights, it does include on the grounds of language, so it might be something that we can look at a little bit more in terms of the human rights framework. But in terms of the what we have across, I can't speak on behalf of all of NHS Scotland, but I know that, for instance, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde do have a BSL plan in place in action that flows from that, and other boards will have similar plans in place already.
I quoted the DDA 2005 because that is relevant legislation to I feel to what we're discussing. There is no doubt that people who are profoundly deaf from birth are at a great disadvantage. This is a very, very vulnerable community or group of communities. I think it is important that every effort is made to expand opportunities and address issues. And it's really how do you go about that? And there are ways other than primary legislation.
The difficulty of the disability label, but I think we worry about the existing support provision that is guaranteed under the Equality Act, and that's where our concerns lie. But that might not be there under another act, another bill.
Sorry, I missed that.
It might not be available under the bill.
Okay. I mean, I think if you talk about being a vulnerable group, I would suggest that that's because that we're not listening to what the community want, and so we define what is best for the community rather than hearing what they're telling us is best for them. We heard in evidence, and we've seen in written submissions and in the Facebook submissions, that the Equality Act, the Human Rights Act, isn't standing up at the minute. Particularly in the health service has been the examples, but we're given other examples this morning. But in the health service, where provision should be made, and obviously you spoke about the Human Rights Framework and the Equality Act, but that isn't being implemented in the way it should be, and that a lot of people we've seen in written submissions have said you could implement that right, but you would have to go to lawyers, you would have to take it from a formal process, and frankly, they're not enabled to do so with the barriers that they're already facing. Therefore, do you not see this bill as promoting language would help with the Equality Act and Human Rights Act and act in with that rather than against that and be an add-on to that?
Generalisation to say that the needs of the profoundly deaf communities are not being addressed by NHS in Scotland generally. I think you have to look. Well, I think you have to look
but,
at.
Sorry,
the work.
Sorry. It, you added generally to what I said. Therefore, that's a problem where
okay,
we go.
Well,
so,
okay,
so, in, so it would be absolutely if I'd said that, but that's not what I said.
Okay, I stand corrected. It is important to look at what public bodies are doing at an individual level. Some public bodies are exemplary in their provision, perhaps others are less so. In Grampian, we take advice from the local deaf communities. We have involvement events. The agenda that we set is their agenda. We're not imposing an agenda, we are asking, what can we do to make our services more accessible to you? What will make life simpler? And that is the agenda that we are following.
The question was, so you didn't address that, do you think the BSL bill will add to the Equality Act and Human Rights Framework?
Yes, I think it would.
Okay,
but there are other options as well.
Understand that, but that was my question. Katy?
I think it's concerning about the examples of people experiencing poor access to NHS services, and you know, we would hope that that is not the case throughout Scotland, and unfortunately there have been cases where that has happened. I suppose in our thinking, it's can we make sure that public bodies, including the NHS, is following the Equality Act requirements better, to make sure that the needs of BSL users are being addressed, and should we focus more on that rather than developing new plans around BSL? But I suppose our position is that we are We'd like to see the Equality Act and the Human Rights Act being used better by public bodies, and we're not, just not sure whether the requirement to do an additional plan would strengthen that or not. In terms of NHS Health Scotland, we're a national board and we provide a lot of information, health information. We have recently been reviewing our inclusive communications policy and have been doing a health inequalities impact assessment on that policy, and we constantly review that. The requests that we get for BSL translations and hope to be responsive to that, and that's something that we keep under review, and I've listened with interest this morning to the panel's discussion, and certainly we'll feed that back both to our own organisation and to the broader NHS Equality and Diversity Network.
Just what you were saying, and it doesn't seem an unreasonable proposition. I don't think any of us are in the business of wanting to legislate simply for the sake of it. But as Siobhan was indicating there, we've got an Equality Act from 2010, a DDA from 2005, and a human rights framework that's been in existence for as long as this Parliament. And while there are undoubtedly exemplars in the health service, in education, in a range of public services across the country, clearly the message is that that's patchy. And I think what we're getting back from the deaf community is a frustration that despite these legislative levers, which let's face it, are significantly more substantive than this bill, but despite that, we're seeing this patchiness, and that what this bill perhaps offers an opportunity to do is identify and symbolise the importance that we attach to BSL, and that then those levers through the Equality Act, through the human rights framework, we can start to see a more consistent approach to improving access for the deaf and hard of hearing community. Is that not an unreasonable, or is that not a reasonable proposition for them to make?
I don't think it's unreasonable, and welcome the opportunity to have, you know, to hear the arguments and the discussion around that. I think it would just be want to flag up a concern if we've got existing legislation which covers some of these issues in terms of equity of access to NHS services, and that's currently not working. Would additional legislation focused particularly around BSL, would that work in practice as well?
The challenge for us has been almost to manage expectations, in that what this bill will do but what it won't do, I think is something that we've been wrestling with. But I think through the evidence we've taken so far, it would appear that the levers for making progress here aren't through the delivery of plans, but that gives it a status that can then be enforced by praying in aid the Equality Act, the Human Rights Framework and DDA.
What you are very eloquently expounding is perhaps highlighting an enforcement and monitoring issue, in that I would agree there is inconsistency, and there is a need to ensure consistency and to enforce the regulations and the law and legislation which is already in place. And I would agree that perhaps, the BSL bill would give a much higher profile to the role of BSL, but there would still need to be some stepping up of regulatory mechanisms. Otherwise, the BSL bill could be brought in as the BSL Act, but not take the debate and the needs of meeting the needs of the profoundly deaf communities any further forward.
Okay, thank you. Colin.
I'd like to ask the panel really the same question I asked the previous panel. Some of the people giving evidence, some of the groups giving evidence, indicated a concern that the bill would use up scarce resources, and indeed COSLA stated there is a risk that it would become an expensive bureaucratic exercise. We're using resources here on developing plans. Is that the best use of resources, or could these same resources be used to better support BSL users?
I mean, I can start and other people can come in as they wish. I think what you heard from the first panel was clearly a desire for more services, for more support, either translation services or direct support and access for BSL users. I think what the bill does is create a mechanism for establishing plans. What it doesn't do is create a mechanism for establishing additional services for people. And I think that's an issue as we see it. Clearly, as Mr. McArthur was outlining, there's a need for managing expectation about what this bill actually does, and there's a balancing act there. But our concern is that if you look at certainly the financial memorandum and the spice briefing, the upper end of the cost, and I granted that's for everything in there, is about £6 million. That's not an insubstantial amount of money, and whether that would be better spent in other ways to actually invest in frontline services. So clearly there's a concern for us. Yes, there's maybe a need for promotion and giving BSL a status that perhaps it hasn't had in the past, but that doesn't in itself necessarily lead to the actual services that would make people's lives different.
So, Colin, James has got a supplementary. Do you mean, are you still?
I've got more to ask, but yes, if James wants to come
point. Okay, James.
Regarding Mr. Nicol's comments there, I thought it was pretty clear from the first panel that they thought that the bill was a very, very strong symbol about how to move forward with BSL. You're right that everybody would like more resources for different services, and they did make that point, but nobody at any point said that they thought that that money should be better spent with more services than they did on the bill.
Well, I suppose what we're outlining is the fact is that is the money that's been invested in this bill truly the best way of getting money for communities and BSL users? And I suppose all we're outlining is as an alternative question.
The point I'm making is that the panel said that they felt it was.
Well, I don't want to put words in the mouth of the panel members, but you asked us a question, you asked COSLA a question as to whether we think
and
that...
And you referred to the panel.
Yes, but they also talked about the services that you would have to spend money on, translation services. The bill does not deliver translation services. The bill allows plans to be developed. If you are saying that translation services are what you would want to invest your money in, then clearly that's not covered by the bill.
Can I just jump in here and make a point? The Gaelic language, much of the criticism of the BSL bill, I think probably is repeating the criticism that was made of the Gaelic language bill when it was first proposed. Yet we have seen now the National Gaelic Language Plan in place. I see even in my local train station that Gaelic language signs have appeared. There seems to have been exactly what was predicted, a change in the mood and the attitude towards Gaelic. So people think about it more and they think about what they should do in terms of when they're changing signage or when they're doing other things or when they're producing material, they think about Gaelic now. Isn't really that's what we're talking about here? The evidence about what the BSL bill, if it became an act, would do is exactly what has begun to happen with Gaelic.
I think that's an entirely appropriate thing, and we're not arguing for the promotional aspects of that. I suppose all we are saying at a time of scarce resources, you have to be absolutely certain that that is indeed what you want to do, and I think there's a counterpoint to that, and all we're doing is to make that point clearly. It's for the committee to make a judgment and a balance on all these issues.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, Colin.
Just moving on from that one, what does the panel understand by the term promotion of BSL? What specific things should that entail?
A basic is to ensure that we have in all areas of Scotland sufficient numbers of properly qualified BSL interpreters. Now, speaking for the northeast of Scotland, NHS Orkney has one qualified BSL interpreter. In Grampian, we have four, one of whom has been not available to us due to maternity leave. Now, there are occasions, maybe every 5 or 6 weeks, when we have to rearrange an outpatient appointment simply because a deaf person wishes to attend, but we don't have a BSL interpreter available to us. A concern of my colleagues and members of deaf communities in Grampian is that we do not have sufficient BSL interpreters. And
as opposed to promoting BSL?
It is important to promote BSL, but you need to have BSL interpreters available. You can promote a service, but if you don't have the wherewithal to meet the demand from that service, it's a very serious issue. So it's a case of promoting, yes, but also ensuring that you have the sufficient BSL interpreters, the resources available to meet demand. And at the moment, there are issues there.
Probably just add around the promoting it, having listened to the committee, the panel earlier this morning, it's about promoting BSL as a language in its own right, and that's certainly something at Health Scotland that we would be doing anyway as part of our work in terms of promoting inclusive communications around the publications that we produce. So when we review our policy around that, ensuring that BSL and our staff are aware that BSL is a language and that they are sufficiently trained in understanding around that. And I think without wanting to speak on behalf of other NHS boards, I think in terms of staff training, that's something that they would do in terms of promoting BSL as a language.
Just moving on from...
We have to interrupt you again. I think Gordon's got a very small supplementary on this point.
I get the impression, rightly or wrongly, there's a wee bit of resistance to any more legislation coming through. So what I'd be keen to understand, given the views of the first panel, is what action is your organisation currently taking to promote BSL, and how effective is that current promotion?
I can speak for our local areas rather than the national picture. We promote BSL web clips on the Falkirk Council website, so if there are particular things happening in the council, and it wouldn't be only on social work or health, or social work or education, it would be across the council business, we would have a web clip. It might be that the bin times are changing or the colours are changing or new bins are being issued, but those basic information, which is quite important. We offer translation slots. I know that in the previous panel they talked about letters and not being able to have them interpreted into their language. We have an afternoon a week where people can come and bring letters and have them explained. And I suppose at a more national level, we have locally online interpreting. But the Scottish Government are rolling their NHS 24 pilot of online interpreting. That's being rolled out to all public bodies from the 22nd of March. So that's something that will actually promote access to BSL to all of our service users.
Within Grampian, we work closely with North East Sensory Services. We work closely with Aberdeen Action on Disability. We have involvement events. We do everything possible to make it clear to members of the different deaf communities that BSL interpretation is available. And I think that's very important. Within our own staff, we do introduction to BSL training every year. And we have staff who've gone to level one and level two, not to replace the professional BSL interpreters, but to act as communicators, people who can greet members of the deaf communities when they come to outpatient clinics and help to give reassurance and support. I think that in Grampian and certainly on Orkney as well, our local deaf communities are aware of the availability of BSL interpretation services, and we make them freely available.
Heriot Watt offers BSL degree now, and we also have students studying with us at both Masters and PhD level. We encourage people to apply for courses, and they will be ensure they will be supported. And we'll be looking to further look at access to services, how easily students can access services.
paid. Thank you.
I seem to be hearing from the panel that promotion of BSL is somewhat dependent on availability of BSL interpreters, and that the interpretation of the word promotion really is about access to services and additional services. Is that how the panel sees it?
Making sure that members of the local deaf communities are aware that BSL interpreters are readily available when accessing healthcare, and making sure that all members of the communities know that it's available to them. It is provided by NHS Grampian and NHS Orkney, and it's there and it's readily available. And that is not a cash limited budget. Whatever we need to spend to ensure that when healthcare is provided, members of the deaf communities have effective two-way communication, that is what we provide.
Is that an interpretation of promoting?
Well, I would be happy to hear what you would suggest as an alternative to that definition.
Happy to hear what the panel thinks about promoting.
The promotion that was talked about earlier around about Gaelic language and trying to build public awareness and knowledge about BSL as a language, and I think that goes on top of this sort of how do you access local services, what's available to you, that's been sort of outlined already. So there's two aspects of that. Now, perhaps the bill might help with the first one, which is the public awareness of the language. I think we've put a note of caution is around what it does to signpost towards services and raising expectations, but additional services that might follow on from that local promotion. So you've got the two aspects of it there, and we can clearly see there's a it could be helpful for one, and it could even be helpful for the other, but only if you manage expectations about what you're actually going to be delivering in terms of local services.
Okay, thanks, Colin. James.
Thank you, Convener. There's been a number of comments suggested there could be some unintended consequences for other languages or forms of communication used by the deaf community, mainly around a detrimental effect on the available resources to support people with other communications needs. Do you have a view on whether these other forms of communication used by deaf people could be negatively affected by the BSL bill, and in what ways?
In our area, we have a contract and it's across communication support. So the contract we have is for 10 hours of interpreting, and that would cover BSL, hands-on signing, deafblind manual, lip speaking, note taking. I suppose one of the concerns I would have is if we have to then take BSL out of that, or that's dealt with differently, the economies of scale may not be as is, and it could become more costly for us rather than less costly.
That was a possibility for the bill that had to be separated. Would it not just be that you would have to monitor what you were?
I suppose that's for me the bit that's not totally clear in the bill, because the bill is very, very clear that it's BSL and it's about BSL, and so I'm not clear about what that will mean for those other the other communication support needs of which we have many, and certainly in terms of our population, there would be a greater majority in the other group requiring the sort of note taking support or communication aids which would be.
Sorry, can I just clarify that then? Are you saying that the BSL plays a minority role in terms of the services that you give? Because the panel, correct me if I'm wrong here, but the suggestion from the panel was that the BSL was the largest part of those services.
The service that I manage is across sensory impairment, so within that BSL, the numbers would be the smallest. The percentage of time allocated would be higher, but the numbers of the population would be lower because it's across sensory impairment.
Okay, thank you for that. Did anybody else got any comments?
We have similar concerns. At the moment, we're probably in the unique position that we have access to funding called Disabled Students Allowance, and that provides any support that a deaf student would need, and includes note takers and things like equipment, video cameras. So it covers a range of support And just this focus on BSL alone raises concerns for us in that area.
So you would need some kind of security around the fact that the resources weren't going to be diverted from the other services?
Yes. I mean, these resources are directed at the individual. It's their money, it's their funding, and they can use it in the best way, you know, for their own communication. We would meet with a disabled student early on, a deaf student early on, find out exactly what their needs are, and then we can apply that funding to cover all of their needs, not just BSL.
Does anybody else have any comments?
BSL is obviously very, very important. For people with acquired profound hearing loss, lip reading is also very important. And in terms of using BSL, especially amongst the younger users of BSL, the 3G and 4G mobile phone technology is very important, because I have seen on a regular basis younger BSL users holding the phone and Skyping or FaceTiming and signing to each other. And it was suggested that I put forward the idea that perhaps some Scottish Government support for members of deaf communities who wanted to use these facilities, perhaps some financial support toward smartphones, Androids, to make sure that these tools, which can be quite expensive, are readily available.
Okay. Can I just take you on, sorry, there's no other further comments on that. Right. Can I just take you on to another question about whether the bill should include specific reference to the needs of deafblind BSL users, and if so, in what way?
Deafblindness. There's a wide variation, and certainly the last panel said that people who are deafblind come from a BSL background. My experience is that many of them are visually impaired first and blind and then become deaf, and so their first language would be English, and therefore I think care would need to be taken, and it would need to be spelled out as to what part of the deaf-blind community you were referring to.
Don't see it as being a straightforward.
Not straightforward. No.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else?
No. We have no deaf-blind communicator in Grampian. We had one deaf-blind communicator who has retired and made it clear that they no longer wish to provide services. So when we require a deaf-blind communicator, we have to bring them up from the central belt, which obviously involves a great deal of planning.
Need for some kind of move on,
yes,
highlighting the importance of deafblind communicators?
Absolutely, and the need for additional training.
And possibly through this bill?
Through this bill or whatever other mechanism the committee considered appropriate.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Just on that point, Mr. Firth, if that is the case, and obviously you have to go out with the health board, then how are you meeting the needs through the DDA and Equality Act, as you spoke of in the first question?
By bringing up a deafblind communicator from the central belt.
That take for the user and their appointment in the health service, and if it's an emergency?
It can take several days. It depends on the availability of the deafblind communicator.
So the point is, if it's an emergency, if you're in a health situation, as you can imagine, and everyone's stressed, having to wait several days for an interpreter...
Nobody waits days for emergency treatment, with respect.
So you would just go without the interpreter in that case, then?
In those circumstances... it would be a clinical decision, obviously, but in those circumstances, there can be assistance from family members. But our preferred option, if there is time and it is circumstances dictate, our preferred option is to bring a deafblind communicator to Grampian.
Okay.
Doesn't this just highlight the problem with the equality of access that we've heard from the first panel and from many who have contributed to the committee's work so far on this bill?
It highlights is a need for I personally would like to see the degree courses which operate to train BSL interpreters, I would like to see them fully funded, and I would like to see the individuals undertaking these courses salaried during the course of their training. In the same way that nurses in training are salaried. And then perhaps once they had completed their training, a guaranteed minimum income for 3 years, because most tend to be self-employed, a guaranteed minimum level of income for 3 years. We need to get more people coming forward to be trained as BSL interpreters. We need to have more people coming forward to be trained as deafblind communicators.
Are you saying to us that you currently have a vacancy or vacancies for both interpreters in BSL and deafblind?
No, we do not employ deafblind communicators. We do not employ BSL interpreters. Of the ones we access in Grampian, three are freelance, and we have a service level agreement with them, each of the three individuals. The fourth person works for Northeast Sensory Services, and we access them through Northeast Sensory Services. So there are four in Grampian, and that's how we make sure we have access to those four.
Okay, but on the deafblind BSL interpreter, are you currently advertising, pursuing, trying to find somebody in the area?
We have tried to find somebody. We know that that individual is not available, and that's why we bring someone up, a deafblind communicator from the central government.
Sorry, maybe my question wasn't clear. I understand that the person that you've been using in the past is currently unavailable. I get that. What are you doing to pursue a replacement for that person locally in the Grampian area?
Right, there isn't a replacement in the Grampian area. We have asked all of the various agencies. We have sought far and wide. There is no one in Grampian who can fulfil that role.
There is nobody in the entire Grampian area who
is a qualified and trained deafblind communicator.
Okay, thank you. Liam.
Thank you. Before turning to the issue of ministerial responsibilities, there's a comment I think made by Maria about the use of English and the development of sight loss and then loss of hearing as well. And I think, Katy, you referred to publications that are produced, and I think Lorraine, you were talking about note-taking support. It did strike me that we're talking about BSL as a verbal language. What predominantly is the written language of most users of BSL in Scotland? Is it English?
BSL is a visual language. It's not a written language. Yeah. It, in terms of service delivery, for us, it comes within the communication support. And just incidentally, following on from some of the difficulties that they have in Grampian in terms of getting deafblind communicators, our greatest difficulty in the Falkirk area would be to get lip speakers. There's a huge dearth of lip speakers. Now, that would be that those people would be coming from an English background, having lost their hearing. But that's a kind of area that there isn't a course in Scotland at the current time, and that's an area that's much more difficult for us.
Right. Okay. Moving on to the issue of ministerial responsibilities, obviously the bill talks about having a minister, a dedicated minister responsible for BSL. The Scottish Government have expressed some anxieties around that, pointing to sort of collective responsibility, albeit that the responsibility for the national plan would fall within a particular portfolio and therefore under a specific minister. I'd just be interested in the panel's views about whether or not a dedicated minister would be a positive or a necessary requirement under the bill, and if so, what the responsibilities of that minister specifically ought to be beyond the development of the national plan.
I don't think we've got a strong view on it. I can see government's point of view in terms of collective responsibility across portfolios. We do at the moment have a minister with responsibility for languages, so there is a potential logical home for BSL within his portfolio, potentially. But but we don't have a strong view as to whether there should be a responsibility given to one minister or not. Clearly, what goes in the national plan, I think there'll be probably some discussion on that later on, is of an interest to us. But the actual ministerial responsibility, I think that's for government to decide, albeit we do have a language minister at the moment.
We have a strong view on that position.
The government's also proposed the idea of a national advisory group or national advisory body made up, obviously, of ministers, COSLA, and also representatives of the deaf community. I think the latter have indicated, I think, a general support for that, but stress the importance of ensuring that the group as a whole is a majority from within the deaf community. Again, are there any comments that you would make about the desirability, the effectiveness that such a group could perform, and indeed the balance of membership?
Sorry. I think the relationship between the advisory group and the national plan is an important one. I mean, clearly, it would be helpful, I think, if we are to have a national plan that is developed in a consultative way that engages with everybody involved within the BSL community, but also service providers as well. Our strong preference is to develop anything in a joint basis, and to do that in as joined up a way as possible. So the actual membership of the advisory group would clearly need to represent everyone who's involved. So it's potentially quite a large group, so it's not without its challenges in terms of operation on that. But if you are to have a national plan, then at least there's a logic to actually having an advisory group to advise us on that, albeit we've got some issues about what would be potentially in the national plan and how that might relate to local plans within the proposed legislation.
Then a risk we need to be alive to that, as you say, the group doesn't get so big as almost to be unmanageable. And is there perhaps a case for saying you have a national advisory group that has the potential and the scope to assign bits of work and input to others who may not necessarily sit on the group on a standing basis? Is that a model that might work?
That sort of model works well within government. It's the sort of having a subgroup or whatever you'd want to call it. I mean, that's pretty tried and tested in terms of civil service practice. I don't think that's a difficult thing.
But just to be clear, there wouldn't be a resistance to the proposition from the BSL community that whatever the configuration and whatever the size, that actually they would have a majority as service users on that group.
I mean, others can speak for themselves. I mean, clearly, I think we need to know what the exact remit of the group is and what it's actually there to do. I think once you've got that, the membership would have to follow the function of the group. Clearly, it has to be representative of all the interests around the table, and I think we'd make a judgment on that once we've actually seen all the detail. I don't think we can go further than that at this time.
Yeah, although in a sense, those from service providers will all have sort of official titles and jobs functions that provide a persuasive case as to why they should be on the group. I suspect for service users, it may be a bit of a greyer area, and therefore, unless we accept the principle that actually there should be that inbuilt majority favour of service users, there is a risk that justification for membership is easier to be made on the service provider than the service user side. Is that a fair concern?
I can accept that lining argument. I suppose all I'm saying is there's a potentially large group of people to be around that table. There is a discussion to be had about the principle of that, and we don't have a strong position on whether there should be a majority of BSL users on the committee or not. I think what we have a stronger view on is how potentially the national structures that might be set up, how that those might relate to local structures, and what the through flow of information is between those. The actual national group, if it's to be set up, you would have to look at exactly what the function of that group would do. But your lining reasoning I would accept, but you'd need to look at everything in the round once you've actually got the detail.
Yeah. I don't know whether you were in for the first panel, you may have heard, but I did ask them, and I'm going to ask you about the Scottish Government's view or suggestion that listed authorities, instead of publishing plans, should publish a statement. Their idea being that the statement would set out how each authority plan to make progress towards priorities identified in the national plan. I just wondered what the panel's view was of this question of a plan versus a statement.
Provided it fulfilled the primary function, which would be to give BSL the appropriate recognition and provision that it requires across Scotland, across the bodies. It would be, I suggest, for the committee to decide which would be the best option, and that the vehicle might be the equality outcomes, which all public bodies in Scotland were required to produce under the Equality Act 2010, Specific Duties Scotland Regulations 2012. And they are coming up for updating in April of this year. So there are a number of vehicles, but I would suggest it would be for the committee to decide which vehicle they consider to be most appropriate to take this forward.
Okay.
I think a statement could be symbolic in the way that the BSL community want to see their language recognised, and also it could set out what an authority plans to do to make sure it meets the needs of BSL users. There's previous types of statements that public bodies have developed, such as an equal pay statement, which sets out what organisations are going to do to close the pay gap. So it could follow something like that, or it could be much more worked up in terms of a statement, which might actually have some outcomes attached to it. So I think there's various ways that could work.
Okay.
Point of view, it's important what will be contained within the document, if you want to call it that. So I think it's important that whether it's a plan or a statement, what it is that we're actually saying that we were committing to, whether that's within a public statement or agreeing around a plan. I mean, a statement would suggest an intent to deliver something. A plan might suggest that there's something a little bit more detailed lying behind that. So the language maybe is important, and I can understand why the previous speakers would err towards a plan rather than a statement. But really, the heart of the matter is what is it that's contained within it, and I think that's where our questions lie.
Any comment on this, Lorraine?
Probably guidance is needed on what would be contained before you could decide whether a plan or a statement was the best way to go.
Okay, thank you for that. Gordon?
Just on that point of what should actually be contained within the plans, I'm going to ask the same questions that I asked in the earlier panel. We've heard from the written evidence, and COSLA themselves said that there was a lack of clarity around the expected content of the national plan, and we heard from another written submission that it was quite vague. The first panel highlighted six key areas for them, and they wanted specified a certain level of service and measurable outcomes. What I'm keen to understand from the second panel is, what do you think should be included in both national and the authority plans in order that the plans can be as effective as possible?
That's the fundamental question. I don't think that I would have an answer for that. If you look at what the previous panel talked about, education, health, social care, leisure, employment in early years, all big areas, you're talking probably the largest, there's probably not many public services not covered by that. The issue for us is, what happens, what do you mean about, take education, an area that I know something about compared to the other areas, what additional services are being unlocked by the national plan or indeed the local plan for education that are not being delivered now, and how would those be funded and how would those be resourced, not just in terms of actually money but staff time and being able to get suitably trained and qualified people. So it's really the thing is, is this a rearticulation of what's already out there, albeit with to some extent a greater prioritisation specialisation and maybe promotion, or is this about unlocking new resources to go into new service delivery? And that's really the question for us. And if it's the latter one, I think that means that you're looking at quite a different sort of piece of legislation that we'd inevitably have to have be further funding to allow it to be delivered properly.
No, nobody else want to comment on that?
No.
No.
Service, it would be around the equity of access, which I would suggest is covered already through NHS Board's equality outcomes and their plans around interpretation and communication support for patients.
Right. There has been a suggestion that the preparation of plans, and you just did it yourself, Mr. Nicol, will divert funds from other areas to support that currently support the BSL community. Is there an estimate of what the additional costs would be for your organisation? Have you calculated how much the potential additional costs would be?
The only work that we've done is effectively to look at the financial memorandum, so we haven't done any additional costing. I suppose what we're saying is if you are and it would appear to be that there's around about £6 million of additional costs. Government estimate that they spent around £2 million, or plan to spend £2 million already over 2016-2020 in BSL. So that would be an additional cost of £4 million. There's a question as to where that additional cost comes from, whether that's met within existing budgets or whether that's funded by Scottish Government. If it's to be met within existing budgets, then that clearly would put pressure on something and you'd have to make a choice whether that comes from outside this sort of sensory impairment budget, or whether it's within that would have to be a choice. It would have to be weighed up, but clearly there's a concern for us if there isn't additional funding and there is some additional responsibilities to statutory to comply to, then that could divert resources from elsewhere.
Anybody else though? Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. George.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I've asked a similar question to the last panel, but the bill obviously about performance review, it's all about seeing how we actually best practice, share best practice, ensure that we deliver on everything that we're wanting to do. But each parliamentary session, the Scottish ministers should undertake a performance review of authority plans, and that includes an account of measures taken and outcomes attained. Now, many of the organisations involved thought the performance review was a good mechanism for holding public authorities account, but COSLA actually felt that it was confused and confused the accountability relationships that exist within local government. Robert, can you tell me why? Can you explain that to me then?
Local government is not accountable to Scottish Government. I think that's the heart of this. But clearly, what we're arguing about is if there is to be an enhanced accountability for service delivery, that should be with local communities, and we heard a little bit of that this morning as well. What we're not saying is that there isn't a need for potentially for national planning and cooperation nationally. Clearly we have the ability to translate national priorities into what happens locally. We have single outcomes agreements and elsewhere. So there are mechanisms for translating a national sense of direction into what happens locally. But I think what we are concerned about is the language round about performance review. Who is performing, reviewing the local plans? Who makes a judgment as to whether a plan is fit for purpose or not? We have a range of services covered potentially within this. Education is one of them. We already have scrutiny structures for education, of which independent scrutiny is brought to bear on service delivery. We have other forms of performance appraisal internally within authorities, as well as external through things, organisations like the Care Inspectorate and such like. So what additional things are we actually creating here for the specific purpose of this piece of legislation? So the question for us is, where is the most appropriate accountability to lie? I think arguably if there is to be an enhanced accountability between BSL users, it should be at the local level and not necessarily at the national level, albeit, as I've said, there are mechanisms that can be, to some extent, you can get the best of both worlds.
The actual BSL performance reviews, the basis of which is for the Parliament to hold Scottish ministers to account and for ministers to hold listed authorities, of which local authorities would be one of them, to account as well. So basically we're giving everyone the opportunity, the bill would give everyone the opportunity to the be open and democratic. I just find it difficult. Having been a former councillor myself, I know how community planning partnerships work, and one of the concerns that the British Deaf Association Scotland had was that they wanted to make sure that it was not just a simple box-ticking exercise, that we actually shared, as they said earlier on today, shared best practice. And would, how would we possibly, if we kept everything at a local level, how could we get a national picture of how things were going? Because we're all accountable in this, to, in order to make sure that we can make this bill actually make a difference.
There's a difference, in my view, between getting a national picture and ensuring national and ensuring a direct line of accountability for delivery, and then making a judgment as to whether somebody's succeeded or not in terms of service delivery. Clearly, there are ways in which we can get a national picture about certain aspects of whatever strategy you would want to implement, and you can choose how to report on that. I think where our concern lies is this notion of performance appraisal, effectively, about how a national organisation such as Scottish Government would performance appraise a local organisation like local government for something that the local authority would have closest to the community, closest to the services that they deliver, and effectively you're almost getting in a second guessing situation as to who actually knows best, and that is a concern for us, and all we're doing is flagging up the fact that we see that is a concern.
Ken, one of the things that the British Deaf Association for Scotland says, that this whole idea of a national performance review give a sense of collective shared mission to achieve the goals of the plans with the community it serves. Authorities would thus become accountable to the BSL community to ensure engagement, involvement, dialogue and continuous improvement. Is that not something we should all be kind of embracing when we're going down this route and looking at ways to break down the barriers so that we can all work to deliver this?
Arguing for against enhance local accountability so that local people, whether BSL users or other, have another sensory payment or something like that, can access services and then can have a genuine say about the services they offer and can have can play their part in their local processes. That's we're not arguing for that. All we're arguing is it. We see a concern between the nature relationship between the national organisations, which Scottish Government is one of them, but the national body as well, that could be the national group that could be established, and how that relates to local decision making, and then who makes a judgment later on as to whether something's happened that there's a feeling that performance hasn't been as successful as we'd like, and then who makes a judgment on that, and then what happens after that. So that's the concern we're flagging up.
Robert, I'm just trying to get my head around this, because basically, even if when you heard the first panel earlier on today, they were even talking about the limited sanctions that are in the bill are just effectively, you know, don't do it again kind of thing, do better, must do better. So they were even talking about they wouldn't even go to that extent. We would try and find, if there was an issue, go into an area and try and work together to actually make sure it's working. So is it not, Robert, with the best will in the world, are we not being a wee bit paranoid about the situation here, you know?
I wouldn't say we're paranoid. All I'm saying is we're an organisation that represents local authorities. We are effectively stressing the importance of local accountability, where we think if there is to be a sanction, it should be a sanction by the local community on the local authority through the mechanisms that already exist and could be established. I think we would have a big concern as to whether there is a sanction taken by a national organisation to impose that on a local authority authority, and then making a judgment that that is indeed the correct thing to do. I mean, that's a very consistent thing for COSLA to argue. So it's not it doesn't necessarily apply to this and doesn't apply in other areas. It's a consistent thing. Where there needs to be that real strong connection is at the local level between communities and those who service and deliver services on their behalf.
Thank you. I've got a final question. Sorry, Nigel.
It's a different situation within health, because health boards are already subject to very thorough annual reviews and the annual review process. I could see no possible reason why the needs of the local deaf communities and the BSL requirements could not become an integral part of that annual review process. In addition, as part of the review process, the minister and team undertaking the review also meet with local people. So it would be quite possible to include local BSL users in the formal meetings process, so that the needs could be assessed and whether they were being met. However, I wouldn't see that process as replacing the routine, ongoing involvement with the local deaf communities to find out how well services are being met and to ascertain their needs. I think that would continue, but the annual review would be a good opportunity for external scrutiny as to how well those needs are being met.
Okay. So, Lorraine.
You have duties under the equality mainstreaming, so I wouldn't see a difficulty with expanding this to include what benefits we had brought into this area.
So it could be covered under the current structure that you have in place. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. I just got one final question, which is about the timescales. Obviously the bill, I won't read it again, but it's about every parliamentary session, 6 months after, but 12 months after the first one, etc. What is your view on the timescales proposed in the bill for publication of the National Plan? Robert?
I think our view was it was probably quite complex as it was set out, and I think there's an additional complexity of fitting in with local elections and things like that as well, which are a slightly different timescale from parliamentary elections. So I think if there was a way of simplifying that along the lines of, I think you suggested, through the Gaelic language, then that would be something we would want to look at. I accept the point that was given about wanting to see progress, and I can understand that, but it does seem quite complex the way it's outlined in the bill.
Okay. Any other views on the timescale? No. Okay. Listen, can I thank you very much for coming along this morning? We appreciate you taking the time to be here with us and to help us examine the BSL bill. I'm going to suspend briefly so we can allow the next panel to come. Can I welcome our final panel for this morning? Our third panel today is Carly Brownlee from the Scottish Association of Sign Language Interpreters, Clark Denmark, who's a BSL broadcaster and former academic, Professor Rob Dunbar, Chair of Celtic Languages, Literature, History and Antiquities at the University of Edinburgh, and Professor Graham Turner, Chair of Translation and Interpreting Studies at Heriot-Watt University. Welcome to you all this morning. Just for everybody's information, Professor Dunbar will be responding in Gaelic to committee questions. Simultaneous English interpretation will be provided through the headsets, which I assume everybody has around the table, while BSL interpretation will also be provided. Can I say to anybody in the gallery who's going to use a headset for the Gaelic to English translation, they should set their headphones to channel one for the interpretation. Okay, if we're all ready, I'm just going to begin. So I'll start with Siobhan McMahon.
Thank you. The first question is whether legislation is necessary to promote BSL and what specific outcomes and improvements you consider the bill will deliver.
Professor Turner.
Just to let you know that I'm only going to be signing for a couple of sentences. I did want to let you know that I am a BSL user myself, but in respect to your first and preferred language being English, I will switch back to using English. Sometimes the deaf community refers to people like me in a slightly light-hearted way of saying that we're hard of signing. So, out of respect to both sides of that equation, I'm going to switch from British Sign Language and go back to my first language, which is indeed English.
So, thank you for allowing me to do that, and thanks for the question. I think we've perhaps heard enough already today to know that there is a pretty strong view that the existing legislation is not meeting the aspirations and the needs of the community. I would say, and did say in evidence, in written evidence, that this isn't a new issue. This is a long-standing issue. Deaf community has been saying in the UK and indeed in other countries since at least 1880 that access to education in sign language is an absolute necessity for the community, and that lots of other aspects of society follow from that. So the conference in 1880 that banned the use of sign language in deaf education set a tone for social provision across the board. We've had disability legislation of many different kinds since the Second World War in particular. We've had understanding that British Sign Language is a real and proper language since the 1970s in the UK. and still here we are discussing the issues and the problems that the community faces. And as colleagues have said already today, the Facebook evidence from the community has shown very, very clearly that despite some of the other evidence you've heard, that provision is in place and the existing legislation can serve needs, etc., it isn't working. And so something a little bit different is required. So the bill, I think, serves that purpose by adding a clarity of focus around British Sign Language as a language. It's not a disability issue. It's not a deaf communication issue. It's simply a linguistic minority issue. And the bill affords us the opportunity to deal with it in those kind of terms.
Okay. Anybody else want to contribute to that? Yes, Clark.
To what Graham has said, this has been a very long wait for the deaf community. Edinburgh should be very proud. The very first deaf school in the world was established here in 1760. So you think, well, hang on, 1760, that was when signing was used. British Sign Language is not a new modern phenomenon, and the research bears this out. They were educated, the children back then, in sign language and with an aim to integrate into society in English as well. But the best way for deaf people to access English is through British Sign Language. So we have over 180 years of history here in this city. This country has the potential to do this. The BDDA, as it was then, with 150-year history, had two very clear aims: the production, the preservation of British Sign Language, and also the insistence of British Sign Language in the education. And there's been countless manoeuvres since then to change all of that. Now, we don't have anything clear since 1889 about clear service provision in the area of education. Now, Graham mentioned the Milan Conference in 1880 banning sign language as one of its resolutions, and that's had a huge knock-on effect. The Royal Commission in Britain was very much swayed by those arguments, and that's led to so many of the problems that we see, not only in education, but what comes from education throughout deaf people's lives. You could almost take the, I mean, it's almost had the point of view of British Sign Language being, an inconvenience, and yet despite all the barriers, the prejudice and the oppression, it's shown itself to be a strong, vibrant language that survives, and it survives for a reason. There were members of that second panel that said, oh, we've got this provision and that provision. Like Graham said, it's clearly not working. The contributions to the first panel, I think, illustrate the failures, and I've got to congratulate the Scottish Parliament for at least opening this dialogue and taking the lead in the UK. The deaf community is delighted by this move.
Thank you. Caroline. I'd like to support both of those comments. I'm here to represent SASLI, the Scottish Association of Sign Language Interpreters. And looking at the second panel, they seem to look at us as a disability issue. We want to remove that view altogether. Really, BSL is a language, it's a culture, it's an identity, an expressive way of expressing ourselves for people who grow up deaf, and also for us to access information through the use of sign language. We don't rely on sound at all. We use a visual language. So this new law will encourage us to see, and encourage all to see, and not BSL as a tool, but part of our lives, not an additional thing that's added on to our lives, it's part of us. And I think the bill will really help with that and take a lead on that.
Thank you. I mean, as the panel have said, we did hear evidence in panel two that suggested that if we were only to implement the Equality Act or do a bit more on the human rights framework, that we would achieve the same outcomes as the primary legislation. Do you agree with that view? And if not, why not?
I mean, I think the of course the other legislation that has been talked about today is not about to disappear. It will still exist, and so the notion here is that the BSL bill will work in tandem with existing legislation, and help to ensure that existing legislation maintains a clear focus on BSL alongside other issues that it deals with. I think earlier on today we were talking about the numbers of BSL users, the numbers of lip speakers required and so on. And, you know, there are, as the census showed, 12,500 approximately BSL users within Scotland. But nobody in this room can tell you how many of those are deaf BSL users. Nobody knows. So we're starting from a very poor basis in terms of knowing what provision is required for the BSL using community. In that context, it becomes very easy for the requirements to support that community to be backgrounded, because we know about other communities. We know about the numbers of people with a visual impairment. We know, for example, about the numbers of people who are using Makaton in Scotland and so on. British Sign Language users who are themselves deaf, those statistics are not available to anybody. So it becomes very easy for the BSL issues to be clouded and lost and pushed to the back of the queue, in effect. So the bill, as proposed, I think, is very much designed to bring those to the foreground when appropriate, alongside the other issues which existing legislation should be able to handle.
And also, Tapluv, son of Horam, a hien gana Hanyav and Jew, I guess, son of Horam Gallic a clerk, Marfast in Ianish and Jew. I'm going to go well build a, I guess, ach, state yet, Erevilla, Jetamoch, vo Hallig, Luch Glaverst na Gallic, Luch Clerkin na Gallic, ach na Gallic, et Jufford Wori Iano. A hoof, lesser hoog, policy in Cian Tradisha Gaelic, who vi artahug Ivaina Gaelic, agus tuksha na mór chuid mun Gaelic, agus ma aimenan agus chuidioch ma vór vienan luch lavarst agus luch clachy na Gaelic. Agus amas mundur gavel luch clachy canan saini vrechten gemakoltoch rishachoesnach Gaelic. Mar a chúlas berha chanye díroch mien conaltri a ha sa chanan. Ha cínalcha di anya, fein anya, ha cínalcha di cúltar, cúltar a ha doin, biastoch, agus cínalcha di canan a ha chastro biastoch rishach Gaelic nio, rishach vierna. Agus saliu sion a ha mbile get the ha na rechgen ella agus get the ha kest coinenoch ele kutrmoch ha feminen agus kutjoch morvienen koersteach na canon show femoch er baroch agus am smunjen gevel a bille show a torst gana koersteach gana diotis de vunien popoloch corum policyen aha kortnichte churichele agus suyachug luch clachgi a horster rörst agus gus anje na morchuch an an alapa arstachug mun chanan, mun chultar agus mwyt dynia aha clachgig na chanan seo.
I would like to agree that there is other legislation in place already. But they mention things like reasonable adjustments. And how do you define what a reasonable adjustment is? Who decides what is reasonable? Is it us or the people providing the services? Who makes that decision? So I feel that this BSL bill, I really support it because it will not depend on reasonable adjustments, but real achievements and outcomes. For example, are there occasions when we've gone to hospital, if the doctor asks you, can you lip read? That's happened to us. If someone says yes, they say that's great. That's the reasonable adjustment made. But that's not meeting our needs. And I feel that the BSL Act would stop that, make sure that BSL is provided for people that want it through the use of an interpreter or through other kinds of information or other ways.
I fully support what the other panel members have just said. We do have existing legislation, not only the Equality Act and the Disability Discrimination Act before it, and there are other pieces of legislation, but they're piecemeal. There is not one clear statement of intent, if you like, about how deaf people who use British Sign Language access services, and that's the stumbling block. We've already fallen over this stumbling block. I mean, what we have in terms of foreign language provision in this country doesn't, I mean, it far exceeds what we have in British Sign Language, which is a British language. When you try, I mean, you know the leaflets that get translated throughout the different authorities and service providers. If we provide equality that way, I mean, from the deaf British Sign Language community's point of view, we certainly don't have it. And when you look, you know, other countries such as the old colonies like Australia and New Zealand, they actually have this recognition in their legislation. And here, back in the so-called mother country, we don't. So we have these old colonies of ours being more progressive, more pioneering than we are. It's been a long way, but it is going to be worth it. We can see what's on the horizon. We can see the attitude that the committee has and that the parliament has. We want to see it enshrined in legislation. The hows and the wherefores and the whys can all be done in collaboration and cooperation with the community.
Okay, thank you. Just before you bring, I want to bring in James Donnan at this point.
Just ask a question. Yes. Right, okay, thank you. I've got a question about unintended consequences of the bill. There was a number of comments that suggested that there could be some unintended consequences that would create a detrimental effect on the available resources to support people with other communications needs, primarily roundabout resources. Do you have a view on that? Could other forms of communication be negatively affected by the BSL bill, and if so, in what way?
I mean, I think all of the responses that people have given earlier in the day have indicated that there is a very clear understanding and appreciation and recognition that resources are limited, and they will always be limited. And the bill, as it's framed, doesn't demand that any particular level or quantity or sum of resources become available. It simply says, from the available resources, may we please ensure that there is a focus when necessary on BSL. And the other thing that I think is absolutely critical is that the community is saying to you, and I think Avril articulated it very clearly earlier on today, that it is a willing partner in working closely with government and with COSLA and with all of the relevant authorities to manage those expectations and use the resources appropriately. It's not asking for a lion's share of resources. It's not asking for anything disproportionate, simply to make sure that what's available is used effectively and is used in ways that the community believes will be of benefit.
I think perhaps I could use a further example. I mean, to go back to the Gaelic comparison, which I think is vital within this context. The Scottish Parliament has already recognised that Gaelic is part of the rich cultural heritage of this country, and we should do likewise with British Sign Language. They are comparable in this way. Now, there's been quite a lot of resources given to Gaelic, quite rightly, in terms of television, other services, provisions and programmes, and one could just say, look, it's only fair. Now, we don't expect things tomorrow. We understand that this is a process. The deaf community has waited, like I said, this long. So I guess from our point of view in Scotland, you know, I mean, of course there will be extra resources required, but let's think about this positively and cooperatively, more strategically, so that you have true partnership between community, government and service providers. The legislation that exists, this new bill isn't going to put very onerous financial responsibilities. What it might do is just give clarity and focus in a centralised way so that the systems that we have already in place are better coordinated and the money and the resources that we have are better spent and focused.
I don't think it will have a detrimental effect on other provisions. Mm-hmm. I think it will be positive actually for them, because as we raise awareness of deafness generally, it will have a positive effect on other forms of deafness. For example, lips reading, deaf-blind communication and so on. I think it will generally raise awareness and really benefit other members of the deaf communities.
Can I just make one quick addition before we move to Professor Dunbar? Thank you.
The British government in 2003 considered this issue of British Sign Language. They decided not to enshrine it in legislation at that time. They did give it a recognition, and we were delighted at the time, but nothing has actually happened since then. There was a small pool of money and this kind of a very tokenistic recognition, and there was a great deal of disappointment in the community stemming from that. So we're sitting here 12 years later where, you know, if you're talking about government expenditure and you compare it, it's been about 5 million across the whole of the UK since then. It's not been well done, not well coordinated, and that's because there was no true involvement of community in that and no real commitment. So I don't know if you're probably aware by now, there's the Spit the Dummy campaign, which has been set up as a reaction to the fact that, I think it was a decade after the legislation, that nothing had really been happened. But what the deaf community has been given is these little tokenistic sweeteners to pacify them and to really to shut us up, in a sense. And I would hate to see a replication of that here, where a small amount of money is given kind of directly, but doesn't have a big effect. We have stated we are willing to work with government and services to make more cost-effective, centralised, smart, strategic ways of meeting our needs.
President
Ball. Sana Canada hami vahus ag Sana Canada hashin inish clachtiri da chanarchas agid an ashin a kuyu agus kuchkan a harakamichin gach turis ha parliamentin torsh astiach Luganin at Canon in Navarroch, Biarkamichinan Mu Hoskishin, Hoskish Navarroch, Agus Kutioch, Buin and Hoskishin Shun at Shervishnele. Is Kindoch on in Canada, Agus Guidan and Alapa, Gavelbeck and Hoskishin and Luib Dachananus, Ekasahitolamach, a sauna saluv buoy echtria hashon, sauna saluv dachro riev shervishin riain, traine griain, asna canonin shon. Ach harunye hanakoskishin shun dolshias. Agus a varokerishon, nur vis buinin popoloch fas klechtri vi tosht shervishin shachet an an canon ele. Hai nasasa shinianu le canon an varok. Mar exemplar anan Toronto, Balamavre, ha me kinioch go duk dachananas ag iddyn asynta bwai policy an hwf canon an ele, se balag yma immigratia a hawn yn Toronto yn drasta, le tor, chanan yn Gambrin, a cha baroch ys baroch herifis yn riain tron y canan yn ele, a sadiwf nach eid dwnia anan bwynion popoloch caet ar sherifis yn imig canan och mar chrapstarig, neu rwydig yn a gwfrych yn chriplis yn siach chormen. Agus am ysmwns yn lesbar hasyn fas nes clechtyr i da chananus agus ymwg chananus an yn alapa. Gym ffas sy'n nes clechtu fi tafyn yn siarafysyn a gwna fi dwplwch yg hosgysyn gachwyd a hasyn brin er siarafysyn y farwch gys o'n cwyrsdech yn canan o'ch ele.
Sorry, can I just pick up Professor DeBar in his statement there? As an aside, I represent the Parliament in Brussels, on the Committee of the Regions. I spend quite a lot of time in Brussels using headphones and translation services. One of the big arguments in Brussels every time I go there is about the vast cost of translation. At no point has it seemed to have reduced in any way whatsoever. In fact, one of the arguments in these times of austerity is about the amount of money that's spent on, well, as part of the budget on translation services and interpretation. I mean, are you really saying that, you know, realistically this could be kept to a minimal cost and effectively would reduce over time? Because that's not what I see when I go to Brussels.
Gallichtje anem Brussel han koskischen kielte die etterhengehug achken an uni jarpich etterhengehug anen immetoch karen. As on look na parliament, yorpich, look ka commission, agus marshin rui. Agus hashin rupek et de yalichtia vo herivishin gan tluag. Marishempler folum, ha dunya bidin et na koskish na varoch, kahan luib folum to vi na galeg. Ach, Nabi mech kayat er folum to vi na galeg an doy et de yalichtia. Hanyashin na bidin cosg aragic er galic, ach cosg aragic er fulham. Sa'n giroch trofian canon ele hae. Agus ha, sy'n ffyr mw herfys yn ele, mae'r esemplar sherfys yn fwnd herfys slantia. Nyr fys cwtych yn ffeimoch er sherfys yn troch anon ele, a ta ffain sy'n nŵn herfys ach trochan yn ele. Ha cosgys yn yn lwyb y fi treinig dwnia ac fel yna sgilyn y sherfys yn sy'n o'r siachet. Ach hanyl nŵn sy'n sy'n dwplych i yn lwyb sy'n sy'n lwyb fi y gater hengychwg ach yn as y ffarn yma chag ysgwyt mor sy'n. Ac ychrechbi gyrbi sy'n ac mwloch prifach ys yn coesneoch na canon swyni freit yn eichyd.
Oh, sorry, Professor Tom.
Just to say, I mean, I think we've heard a lot, and there's a lot in the evidence about concerns about the cost of interpreting. And I think one of the beauties of the bill, as it's specified, is that it does refer us to, or encourage us to think both about access to services, which might, for example, mean the use of interpreters, but also about promotion of the language. And it's the, on the promotion side that we can do an awful lot more than we have been doing, which will mean that the costs of interpreting don't have to escalate. And the rationale for that is the one that the deaf community has consistently articulated generation after generation. And that is, rather than using interpreters, we would wish to have services provided to us directly in BSL, preferably by other people who are members of the signing community themselves. So if promotion begins with educating families in using sign language so that deaf children have the best possible start from the home with their families, then those deaf children have the best chance to grow up to be highly competent, skilled professionals like Clark and Carly and Avril. And you've heard and seen the quality of the evidence that they've given you. And so I think it's very clear that it's perfectly possible to imagine a deaf community that is making that kind of contribution to Scottish society across the board. It starts with the promotion, and the access issues will need to be maintained, but they will stay in their place.
Thank you. I'll bring back in Siobhan. I'll interrupt you, Siobhan.
No, thank you. Firstly, I'll finish on James. James had to leave, and so the question that he was asking other panel members were whether the bill should include specific reference to the needs of deaf-blind BSL users, and if so, in what way? Do you have an opinion on that?
I think it's obviously a very important issue. I have many friends and colleagues that are in fact deaf-blind. Now, we want to be very clear. When we use the expression deaf-blind, there's a difference between deaf-blind and blind-deaf. Because we talk about deaf-blind people as belonging to our community and who have lost their sight. And blind-deaf people are those that were referred to by the second panel of growing up with English and then losing their hearing. And those two groups are very distinct, in fact, almost opposite needs. Because you can imagine somebody who grows up with perfectly good sight and loses their sight for a number of different health reasons, the most prevalent in our community being Usher syndrome. About 6% of the deaf community have this retinitis pigmentosa plus deafness syndrome. So that's a substantial number. So they already use sign language and then encounter these difficulties later and need tactile, hands-on, and a number of different communication issues. It's essential that the bill addresses them as equals, equal participants in all of this.
SASLI also has a group of deaf-blind interpreters, and we feel very strongly that that's part of our community, people who can communicate using hands-on signing and manual. They're an equal part of our community, and we work in partnership with them as well.
Just finally on the first, before we move to James, it was simply, Carly, you spoke in your evidence about how the second panel spoke about disability and disabled rather than seeing this as a language issue, which Professor Dunbar spoke about, the culture aspects of it. I'm just wondering, do you think this bill will go a long way to putting BSL as a language rather than seen as a disability issue?
I believe it really will change attitudes of people generally who know very little about BSL in society. At the moment, people learning BSL are perhaps meeting a deaf person for the very first time. They're being able to learn the language and they don't have that mind view. They think of it as a disability first. So I believe that once BSL becomes much more widespread and people learn the language earlier and younger, at a younger age, it will influence the attitudes of people, and people will see BSL as a language rather than just a way of communicating and not just a disability tool. It's something very separate for us. Our hearing peers help us, they can sign. But in general society, we feel it's very separate.
If I could just add to what Carly said.
Right. We've heard this morning, you heard earlier this morning, you know, the deaf community doesn't accept this disability label and sees ourselves as a linguistic minority or community. But you can actually, there doesn't need to be an either or in there. I mean, clearly we're not going to say we're not disabled. We understand that we can't hear, and that provides barriers in terms of how we access community, access society, but it's the secondary issue to us. The bill recognises that we put our language, identity and culture first. We accept our disability in society, but it's important that it's what the bill does is puts the language first, and that is right. Okay. That recognises our linguistic minority identity.
That's why you've had a lot of evidence and submissions on Facebook from deaf people who really recognise that that's important for us. Okay, thank you. I'm going to have to ask committee members and panellists to try and be brief, if at all possible. Colin.
I'd like to explore the effectiveness of the Gaelic Language Act in promoting Gaelic. And are there any useful lessons learned that could be included in the BSL bill?
Amis mwyn rhywbeth fel lesson yn rhywun sych ag fo ach na galeg agos cwringriaf ach na galeg. An yn dwy hae'r o'ch rha fi cyndioch mw fwy na hachga. Hanec esriach an yn dafil ys y sia. Chai yn y hyd plan eich yn i anw ar yn dafil ys y siach, dafil ys y hoch. Sbol chi'n ha eachdri na hach y car gyrryd. A mys mwyn rhywun gyfel gyharad y bwai y hwg na plan eich yn agos na hach er ffolwm. Agos ffolwm myein na galeg agos ffolwm ans y galeg gyma cwtr moch. Hasrwn gyma cwtr moch anna fi y cwrr yrst na galeg agos anna fi y cwrr yrst na canan y swyni y bretynich. A mys mwyn rhywun cwtioch gyfel mae'r hysyn asafol yma tro hein tro hynichyn agos tro hanesyn ha agalic na saicsynich agos y saliw siwn ha ffysig baroch gwyniau gyfel y chan yn ewn, gyfel y gabrin agos le siwn ha baroch anio anonalap gyfel coesniach gawn gyfel coesniach gyha imig gatio awn agos gyfel coesniach gyha bewal awn agos ha mysmynt yw gyfel na rwtyn sy'n nas cwtymichia cwtioch chachrechby gynjach cwtym gylior y chwyr er sherfysyn trefyn na galeg na ma falsa rwtbeg cws cwtym gachwyr er etyr hengychwg asgyn blianol agos rwyt mor sôn. Rwyt yn ha cwtr moch gynchecw gwrs unaf y na can yn asdychwg. A cham ysmwynt yn gydoch gybyg baroch cwtiwm ed sherfysyn gan llwyg a ha clechig na galeg cwtr moch. Agos sy'n ffaren cwtyn hyn prifachus. Agos am ysmwynt yn y ddys fo'n un eisiau chwyl y sy'n yn diw agos as ni yn eisiau sgrifio ha sy'n gybach cwtr moch. Mae sy'n am ysmwynt yn y rwydyn y garsdych Anya agus tuksha mun choyashnach, mun hulter, agus mun chanan, gama kutumoch, folum, ansa chanan, a dogunia ekabelachanan, ach luch yunsiki kutioch, agus nuoshin sheravishin, kimere hei jackiner sheravishin the shar, or shachet, agus hashin gusori to kutumoch, then a choyashnach shelchanese.
I'm sure you're all very familiar with the Martin Luther King speech, We Have a Dream, and I'll tell you now, like every other human being, we have dreams in this regard. And in terms of what Professor Dunbar was talking about, services and what's going on in television and so on and so forth, there is actually some British Sign Language provision in television, and there are some aspects of cultural programming, such as not See Here is the name of a television program, not The Report, by the way. There's two different See Here's. So that's actually been going since, I think, 1981, one of the longest standing community programs in the world in existence, where other programs come and go. This flagship of the BBC has been widely recognized as an essential service. So we pay the same television license as everybody else. So it's quite right that we expect, you know, perhaps not equity of service, but I mean, it's only half an hour a week. and only for 20 weeks a year, but it's vital because it's that cultural expression of deaf people. It allows us to identify with, you know, the cultural institutions and artefacts, celebrate our life, our language, our culture, not be sad, not be hidden in the corner, depressed as disabled people, to celebrate and enjoy our deaf heart, our theatre, our poems, all those things that we can contribute and add to the multicultural life in Britain. In 1989, again, to congratulate the BBC, you know, they set up programming to allow people to learn sign language. You know, so instead of looking at these courses, you know, we know that people in Britain struggle to learn French and German everywhere. But with an accompanying book and a program, they had a really popular program. I mean, there was a bit of a. I mean, I suppose you could look. We have such a beautiful, vibrant, exciting language to learn. I mean, we could have seen the floodgates open, I suppose. And in fact, they kind of did, you know, as a result of that program, but in a positive, in a progressive way. And it was the responsibility of the deaf community to respond to that. And we did respond to that by training British Sign Language tutors to meet this hugely explosive need. And simple individuals, well, I mean, Princess Diana was a great advocate and ambassador for British Sign Language by being the patron of the British Deaf Association. You know, she raised the profile of our language because she could sign a little bit and provided such a great role model. That encouraged even more people to come to our community. It promoted BSL in the most wonderful way. We've talked about existing legislation and adding to it and perhaps what's working and what's not working. You know, and with the Broadcasting Act, you know, there's 100% requirement for captioning, which is very important for that huge hearing impaired, hard of hearing community whose first language is English. But for people who don't access the world through English, the deaf community very much struggled. You know, we have in-vision interpreters, and that was part of the legislation, giving us 5% of all television programming across all channels. So when you work that out, that's 94 hours a week, which is good and positive in its own right. But do you know when those programs are broadcast? 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning. That not highly visible, not celebrating their language, not putting it out there. So, you know, unless you're a deaf insomniac, you're not going to be taking advantage of that. Now, the education issue is the most important. Now, obviously, we'd love to see it. Look, I have a dream of a BSL channel, yeah, but it might not be a reality, but I'd like to get up at 7 o'clock in the morning, just like my hearing counterparts, and access what's going on in the world, home affairs, foreign affairs, get my access directly through sign language, and then, you know, go to work at 9 o'clock, and I'd like my kids to be able to access children's programming in the same, or educational programming, to have that suite of services available in a very cost-effective way. Allowing, you know, leisure programs as well, chat shows. Of course we want that kind of equity. We have those kind of needs. But the cultural life of deaf people is to be celebrated. You know, it is a dream, but it's actually an achievable dream over time.
I really am going to have to move on because we've got an awful lot of questions to get through in virtually no time at all. Gordon.
I want to ask you about the content of BSL plans, similar to the questions that I asked to the two previous panels. So what should be included in both national and authority plans in order that the plans can be effective? And should there be some detail on the content of plans included in the bill?
Well, to take the second question first, no, I think the way the bill is constructed is entirely appropriate because we don't want to prejudge what the climate might be, what resources might be available, what the priorities might be for successive governments. And so the bill as constructed sets a framework, gives us an opportunity to take the priorities of the day, and that's as it should be. So I don't think there's any strong lobby asking for more detail of the plans to be put in onto the face of the bill. The key thing, I think, about the nature of the planning process is that it is a participatory process. And you know, I was delighted to see the One Scotland work programme for the Scottish Government referring quite clearly to government, paragraph 238, we want to draw more people more deeply into the way that decisions that matter to them are taken. We want Scotland to be an open and truly engaging country where the creativity and wisdom of all its people help to shape our future. That's exactly what the deaf community is asking you for. And so a planning process that affords the BSL using community the opportunity to make that kind of contribution, to engage in civic activism in exactly the kind of way that the programme is anticipated to achieve is precisely what the community is talking about. And I think all of this put some of the discussion earlier in the day in a very different light. As soon as we start talking about comparison between BSL and Gaelic, we're a long, long way away from asking questions about disability and resources around disability. Nobody, for example, asks, can we afford to support Gaelic because Makaton users will be disadvantaged? Yeah. And I think that gives us a clear idea about being in different territory altogether as soon as we start seeing BSL users as a linguistic minority. And I would say then that we're also encouraged to recognise that we're not talking about deaf people's needs. Don't do this because deaf people need you to do it. Do it because Scotland wants it, because Scotland will be a better nation for it.
Okay. Anybody else want to come on? Yeah.
Fyd mi ffacnag ar am fyd mi ffacnag ar am achnag aleg agos a'i carcoltoch rhys y bydd eisiau chanel yn tŵafus an yn achnag aleg my hwspens nym plan i a cha dawrwyd as y bydd eisiau a cha gymacwydwch agos am y smwnsyn hosioch yn yn ymwydoch doi'r achnag aleg yn osioch am bydd gra gan bychor dy fwynion poblwch fi sirig fechgan agos corla fo lwch clechgi na canan agos hasyn gymach cwtrmwch ham ysmwynion gyfel yn corla sy'n cwtrmwch a conltrig lentynioch cwtioch gymach cwtrmwch agos cwtioch ca yn byl y ffiach yn di rysyn planich yn nasynta y ffiach ystriach as na planichen ac bwynion poblwch agos am ysmwnsion y gyfel yn cael sy'n cwtmwch. Fo ach na galeg ha cwach ac bors na galeg stiwrwg y chrwach ac mw hwspens na planichen agos ha bors na galeg ar sy'n ei nhw. Ha ysmwnsion gyro sy'n erbyn fi ffelmal dy fwynion poblwch saliwf nach roed bwloch cyniwch gyda crw bychor fi yn y plan i chi agos fa cesnach gyma hwspens agos am ysbwynion si as yr ad gybyg stiwrig i'n siosio sian ffeilmal ach hwyd yw sian y tîn astiwri gan ach hi yn awn yn eifoch ach am ysbwynion da ffriwns bwyl sian corla agos conol trwy glentynioch yr o'r greu am ach am ysbwynion gyfer sy'n anabawr chi'n cwtymoch agos yn ceol i anw etyr planeg y gyd yn asyn hy agos y gyd yn unadol.
Thanks very much.
Okay, Liam.
Thank you very much. You'll have heard, you've heard all the questions from the previous panel, so none of this is probably going to come as a huge surprise. The issue in the bill in relation to a minister with specific responsibility for BSL, obviously you'll be aware the Scottish Government have expressed some reservations, seeing this more as an issue of collective responsibility, albeit an issue that would sit within a portfolio and therefore fall to a particular minister to drive forward. Be interested if you have any firm views either way, if it is a minister responsible, what the specific duties on that minister would be. And then in addition, the idea of a national advisory group made up of obviously ministers, local authorities, other service
providers, but also service users. And I think within the BSL community, there's a firm view that the majority of that group should be made up of service users. And again, it'd be helpful if we could have your views on the makeup of that, the desirability of such a group.
SASLI does agree with the view that we do need to have an advisory group and with the majority of BSL users within that group. The regions of Scotland are very diverse between north, south. The central belt is very different. North of Scotland is much more rural and has different needs and services. So you need to be able to include people from the regions that can express those different needs within the advisory group. And the lead minister should be there. There should be someone who's there who's accountable, mm-hmm. who can take the work forwards and then cascade it down to different ministers and different departments. Mm-hmm. They should also have a strong understanding of BSL within their work. It shouldn't be an afterthought. The minister should be taking the lead on that and then cascading it down to others. We don't want it to be an afterthought for that minister. And we want the minister to be proactive in making sure that things actually happen as a result of the Act. And yeah, feedback from the advisory board is really, really important in that whole process.
Could I, as the MSP for Orkney, please welcome the fact that that expression of the regional diversity being explicitly set out. But in terms of the ministerial responsibility, I think one of the ideas from the previous panel was that we have a minister for languages at the moment, including the Gaelic language. Is this something that you would see comfortably sitting within that remit, or does it need to be more explicitly drawn out?
For that? First of all, I strongly support what Carly says about recognising the regional diversity of this country. Your question is, should it be one single minister or should it be cross-department responsibility? I think you've already identified that if there isn't one single minister and you put it across all the departments, the level of expertise, knowledge and background between those departments is going to vary wildly, so that one department may well be addressing the needs very well and others very much not doing that case. So you can see the pitfalls and the potential failures in that system, whereas if you have one department or minister ultimately accountable, being supported with a clear remit by an advisory group with expertise, we would see that as the best way of working.
I think the conversations that have been happening in the lead up to the bill have been broadly very clear that the community is quite relaxed about the Scottish Government's position, that there is a shared responsibility. That's the way it needs to be. Equally, as you say, it would be slightly absurd, having recognised that there is a particular linguistic minority, if the minister who's responsible for languages didn't have some kind of role or position in kind of championing the language, if you like. The only other thing I would say about the advisory panel, and of course there'll be a lot of conversation to be had if the bill is successful about the exact composition of that panel and so on, that I don't think needs to be decided today or in the immediate future. But I would just say that, of course, we pick you up, if I may, on the terminology talking about deaf people being part of that panel as service users. Yeah, their contribution to that panel is a great deal broader than as service users. If we think of deaf people as service users only, then we're fixating on the access issues and losing the focus on promotion and the contribution that the community can make to society in Scotland.
I took my reprimand in the spirit in which it's intended.
Well, you know, I mean, it's not usual, but it's kind of you to do so. Can I just go back to Professor Dunbar, though? Obviously, you're well aware of the process that was undertaken when we went through the Gaelic Language Bill and then the introduction of the Act. From that experience, can you give us some information, background, knowledge about how the introduction of plans were introduced, how the development of those plans was a particularly onerous process on bodies to produce plans, and also in relation to what we've just discussed about ministerial responsibility and national advisory boards, etc. I just wondered if you could give us some background with your experience in the Gaelic issue.
Paul sheikh me le cast minister le ulach son nabila son the canon Ha minister er vi akinje vo nøykietiek ker fikets nøykietiek van a hiet law parliament chagas realtis na halapin na son na galik nish na minister le the lessness is on canon in the halapa. Ach, I'm a smoonjun gavella kutumok could be the lessness a kutuken, minister at Horakanoch to the stay real dish, hashin kutumok. Hanin's gavel a Gaelic ervi, a Gaskoshnach, the Gaelic ervi, Gama Forstenoch, less the minister in Hervi Akinye, minister in Draste, Alistair Allen, a Gama Yoloch, Erchanan, a Gama Yoloch, Kestrin and Kielche, the Mian, Agus Feyman, look lavish the Gaelic, Agus Canon Vele, Agus Amasmunjan, the High Gunsehug, who've policy, agus cuiringriaf policy, cianchu di Sigalic. Gama felmal, huv policy, cianchu di canon an eile, canon an suini, amesc canon an eile. Sposin ham esmuinchin gversin erivi cutrmoch ganagalic, gero minister asrialtis, ecero dlesnes, agus erero an tuoloch, su le chumal er groichin. Huv nam planichin ham esmuinchin gvelet erivi sadiofachol, ha borst na galic erivi gopir gudlu lebuinian popoloch, agus varoch ger giroch vi geri erbuinian popoloch planichin na chudi chéle ha borst horst corla, agus taich da vuinian popoloch, agus ham esmuinchin gvel shun kutrmoch, lesmanach bi borst, buin gubuloch coltoch di borst fun villa ha shao ha smunjin gum fame realtis smunjin ed kimere a hejachka ed conaltrug a humal ribuinian popoloch a kutioch kutiochug agus corla horst gaive ha smunjin gavel corla borst na galic ed vi felmal agus gyro kuchka na Chekovin gucha erek avec kuch de vuinian popoloch ha ted in lutehug lesniola sa hakke inish er a frosas agus saliov an taika hat fine von der rielte sa kuchok von a vort smashin hama smungin gevel system is on corla agus stúrug agus kuchuhug a horst de vuinian popoloch gama kutroch an vi lu Kutchug, Kutchgan a Chekovin a Hakke, Agus Stock, Kutchgan a Duliatisen a Hart, a Fechgen, Leshna, Nahuali, Hinura, Hashel.
Okay, just to finish us off this morning, it takes up from a point just raised by Professor Dunbar on consultation. The Scottish Government has suggested that the BSL National Advisory Group can undertake collective consultation on authority plans for a number of reasons, not least because it's slightly concerned, I think, about pressure put on individuals and groups to provide advice and review those plans. What are the panel's views on that suggestion? Professor Turner? On
the suggestion of statements as
opposed to... No, on collective consultation.
Well, as I've indicated, I think there is a spirit abroad in the country as a whole of consultation, and I think it was shown very clearly, and I think the country as a whole is very proud of the 85% turnout in the referendum last year. This is a country that values that spirit of consultation, and I think that's what we're looking to take forward. I think the key thing to add here is that we all enter the process looking for a long-term response to these kinds of issues. These are not things that can be addressed in the short term. We've had plenty of evidence to show that attempts to do so have been unsuccessful one way or another. So it is an incremental process. It is a process of continuous improvement and a process where the community is very keen to engage and participate. I think perhaps the key thing to bear in mind is that contrary to some of the evidence, again, that we've heard earlier today, I mean, I invite you to review the evidence that's been submitted to the committee to date and ask you whether you find very many instances in there in which deaf people themselves describe the services available to them as exemplary. We heard earlier on that exemplary services were out there. So do deaf people tell you that the services are exemplary? I don't think so very often. So there is a process of continuous improvement that, the community is looking for, but it enters into that willingly and in a spirit of partnership.
Well, that may be true, Professor Turner, what you say about exemplary services, but I have to say my experience is that not many people come to me about exemplary services as an MSP across the board, so that may not be the case that we get that end of the spectrum. Just one final question to the panel, and it's a fairly straightforward one. I've asked the others. It's about whether they believe there are advantages in moving to either a 5 or a 7 year cycle for the National Plan as opposed to the one that's currently laid out in the bill.
Well, and the Buinian Popoloch, a Fuoloch, Plana Gaelic, a Hudikele, Femiat, and Plana Urach, Hulukoik Bliana, I guess I'm a smoothing version, race in Gulior, Reunia, Gus and Plana Yalavug, I guess Norsian Vereunia, Gus and Plana Huringriev. Agus am smúinteann go bhfuil a cuttarmach go bhí úne go leor ann. Go háirit mo rútana ha cínte rí lesa go canan, bhí rút car tánte a hán, hán ar a fúrsta cúchga na rútana chur an gríomh go skipulta agus go fúrsta, bhar cúch ach go háirit a húf tréini, a húf fólam, very unia, I guess I'm a smoothing Gavella Kutumoch, unia horst canabunian popoloch, the grieven, a hurring griev. I cast down, I'm a smoothing my vis and ham roate, a dual toch, lickle rutten, a tutum von vorst, Markenbeek. I guess I'm a smoothing Gavishin and Kunnerst, le tamal, a roate. I'm a smoothing Gavel. Coig bliana, sloch becken is coig bliana. Reisn de gulior, verig sin unia gulior, gan a buinian, na gríaf an achga, a chur an gríaf, ag a scrúta gíano ar eifoch gan an gríaf an hasin cutamoch, cutioch, fémi fissabiachga, co iu, vel na hát díano fó na plani chyn a copit, vel na rútan ar a visadio vachod. Agus, sin a dhéanig amach an an úne ha rogarit a chaintsas. Mar sin am a smúntra go bhfuil a cutamach úne go leor a thuirt gan a plána sin. Must be plána eile tíon ar mún a chiad plána.
Carly.
I do agree with Professor Dunbar, but also I think we have to get the view of deaf people. For too long we've been sidelined, we've been marginalised, and we haven't been involved in the process for so long for parliamentary issues, council issues and so on. So I think we need to give deaf people time to make that adjustment in their own mindset, a cultural change if you like, an attitudinal change. So maybe extending that time would be beneficial. To do it in phases, to have a phased approach to it, and rather than rushing things through, because that might lead to the whole process breaking down. So I would recommend a more measured approach, for sure.
I'd just like to re-emphasise what Carly said. It's a fair point to be made. You know, is it 5 or 7 years, an appropriate time frame? It's difficult to say at this point in time. I think the Gaelic experience is instructive and informative because in our discussions, you know, when you think about 5 years, you think, oh, well, it's quite a long time, isn't it? Especially in an individual's lifespan. However, there are some long-term goals and aspirations that we would like to see expressed. I think, you know, because of the existing legislation that we've talked about before, and you know, we're not starting from a point of the ground up. The deaf community does have a different, slightly different experience from the Gaelic experience in some ways, in that you know, our access to court, police, health services is very sporadic, piecemeal, and not. It's not uniform. So I think Carly's idea of a phased process might work better, whereby, you know, in some areas you can imagine changes in education would take much longer than face-to-face changes in social services on a local level. So it's about what's workable, and we're prepared as the deaf community to work with you and to be a lot more complex and not see it as a black and white issue, a lot more grey in there that's to be discussed.
thank the panel very much for coming along. I was going to say this morning, but it's now this afternoon. Thank you very much for your time and for your evidence in this morning. We've obviously got a lot of things to consider when we're looking at the bill. But just for everybody's information, our next consideration of the BSL bill will be on the 17th of March, when we will take evidence from the Scottish Government and from the member in charge of the bill, Mark Griffin. So that's 17th of March for the next evidence session on the BSL bill. And with that, I will close the meeting.